Okay, that's called cheating. Congratulations.
I still have to pay the tokens for them, though.
Oh, I guess that's fair. I guess they have kind of made it at least monetizable for them when you cheat, you dirty rat.
Well, I did report it to Matt.
Yeah, you're an honest cheater.
Right. I mean, it's just that since I last updated him, I've figured out how to... where before it seemed random, I think I've actually, like, stumbled upon the secret sauce.
Huh. Well, congratulations. I minted the first two user pants and shirts, so, you know, I feel good. That's always my goal in any NFT-based game I do play. Like, I want to be the first person to get one of the items for my imaginary future, you know, a Decentraland gaming museum. At this point, it'll be mostly KOA items, but, you know, such is life.
Right, I mean... No,
there's too many games now, you can't play them all.
So what are the highlights of the Knights of Antrim, up of the new dungeon? Well, anything that stands
it's
out?
Only 2 megabytes of data, so, like, it loads, like, beautifully. Like, everyone's been like, oh, man, this, like... Because, you know, their game is big and pretty, and, like, there's some, you know, optimization growing pains over time where some of us have just like, oh, like, this doesn't load for me. But everyone's like, oh, man, it's amazing how, like, quickly and nicely this loads. So that's nice. It's got, like, a good... I don't know if they did all 3 dungeons. I only did the Wasteland yesterday. But it's got, like, a very nice desert vibe.
Those are the other two are placeholders.
All right, that makes sense.
But yeah, the Wasteland dungeon has a lot of like, it doesn't have a lot of like bumps and curves, so it's like it's obvious it's, you know, lower poly. So, Matt was talking in the AMA a couple weeks ago. It was originally like 1 megabyte, but it looked ugly. So they threw some textures at it, and now it looks all right. It looks like it fits in. Probably the big thing for people who actually play is pants. Previously, if you wanted pants for the game, you were buying a mythic. Now there are much more common pants that are loot. And I actually like the way the... doing the dungeon runs has changed. Where before you could do like 2 nightmare runs a day, and then if you wanted to do more than that, you had to pay for it, kind of like an arcade. Versus the current setup, you only pay if you want to claim a wearable at the end.
That is smart, because it's like, because the thing he's trying to battle is the, you know, as we all, anyone who's played any web Decentraland games is, you know, the bots and the like. And the Wondermind grinders, you know, they will just go out of their way to, like, suck the joy out of everything and mint as much as they can and then floor it on the secondary. So this, you know, having it so that you get, because you can use free daily tokens. Like, you don't, because I don't know, for those who are unaware, you get a daily supply of tokens you can use to do the dungeon runs, or now in this case, mint the wearables. Or you can pay and get premium ones, so you can, you know, if you want to, you can play all day long for, you know, like, it's really reasonably priced. It's like, half a mana per token or something. Was I feel like whatever the price was, I remember like, oh, that is temptingly affordable, you monster.
Oh, it's not even it's not even daily. I think they reset the free tokens reset every 6 hours.
Oh really? Oh, I didn't know that. I've been slacking them.
Well, I've also been grinding enough to see the resets. I'm currently ahead of Gabe on the leaderboard again.
Nothing anyone ever says will convince me he's not cheating somehow, but I don't know. I don't know how.
So I've watched him move. Like he doesn't stop, and his movements are like perfect from what I can see.
He's got a bot doing
it. No, he's just
something.
He's just got that speedrunner work ethic.
Fair enough. Okay, fine. He's just really good, and I just want him.
Now, if there's some, because now, if there's some gaping hole he can drive a dump truck through, he's going to do it. But...
Yeah, but said the guy minting two things at once, you know, slap houses.
Yeah, I don't know that he's figured that trick out yet.
Also, for
I leave it to the hyper-focus coder mentality. He just focuses and doesn't stop.
Yeah, for those of you who don't know, you can stack your wearables in Knights of Antrim now. So if you get, like, you know, 1,000 of the rarer, you know, uncommon items, you can, like, you know, benefit from each additional one. So Zesty would be able to speak to the finer nuances of which ones are worth stacking versus not.
Oh,
because
just stack.
But it's a cool mechanic. It's a nice addition for the I think to make the grind a little bit more fun and rewarding. Since, as with any kind of game like this, to an element like any WoW player knows, there's a certain element of just throwing yourself at a task that started out fun and then slowly just becomes a grind. And you're like, well, I need to get the super rare drops, I've got to keep going. So at least this time you always get like a little kind of like, hey, like, you didn't get the super cool thing, but you got, you're better. You're better than when you started.
Yo.
Keep at it, kid. So.
Yeah, I like mentioned recently that like, with Knights of Antrim, it's like so beautifully put together. Like, you can tell that the team has like put in a lot of effort into it, and I just don't play it because once I set foot in there, I don't think I'll make it out. I like just the grind of it. It brings me back to like RuneScape grind or Final Fantasy 14 grind, where I'm just like, yeah, just aimlessly just mining for no reason. It's like, hey, your mission is this. I'm like, yeah, that's cool, but let me mine this ore over here.
I spent like the better part of an entire like month or two in my senior year of high school just trying to kill dragon whelplings in World of Warcraft, trying to get like I can't remember if it was a pet or a steed. I can't remember what they had the like 1 in 100,000 chance of dropping, which never dropped for me. But I spent like the saddest amount of time just killing whelpling in the desert. It was like, my friend was like, why are you doing this? This isn't an efficient thing for anything.
My I have a similar kind of story. I mean, I spent a ridiculous amount of time on Final Fantasy 14 just like taking over their market boards and manipulating prices for like certain items. Yeah, and so I'm like a level like 30 in that after like 1,000 hours of gameplay, but I can tell you that I'm like I have lots of monies in that.
I tried so hard to corner the WoW like market on gold at one point, not the gold, the coins, but gold, the like the mineral you mine, because it was like one of the rarer ones. But there's just I never managed to pull it off. There was always just too many people undercutting me. I'd be like, sweeping the floor, and I'm jacking the prices up, and then someone would always, they'd be like, oh, thank God, I've got more to sell you.
You can't, like, Jared, you can't compete with China and Steve Bannon. Sorry.
Yeah, no, you're correct. One sad 18 to 20 year old does not have the ability to outwork all of the China grinders. Their cost of living, even then, was still lower.
what I had done in Final Fantasy is I found an item, a low ranking mining item that like was needed to craft a new like set of armor or whatever for like the newest patch. So then yeah, I just like basically grinded this level 14 mining item for like months and months and months. Made like 50 mil. Now I don't know what to do with it because I could have bought a house on Final Fantasy 14, but I'm on Decentraland.
Someday Decentraland will have sweet houses that we can all buy. That, I mean, does everyone here have a meta residency tower? I haven't gone to mine in a while, but I really enjoyed it when they first dropped.
I've seen poker tables at meta residency tower. That's pretty dope.
I do agree that I do like that addition. I was kind of like, man, why didn't DG let me get a poker table for my stuff? But that's fine.
Someone once told me they asked DG like how much for a poker table, and they were asking for like 250,000.
I'm willing to believe that, you know, that's, you know, you want to keep your proprietary technology safe, and maybe it depends on the asset. The asset during like peak bull market, you know, the, I could just see them being very protective of their
that also
tables.
It that also cute. Sounds like a fuck you price. And also, Jared, you got all those Consolation Plague shoes.
I'm sorry, PB and Tobik ruined your grant. Don't kill yourself. Gifts from Ryan, and I will always be grateful of his kindness. He literally, because he was DMing me, he's like, "Oh man, like super congrats on that." And then last second, he's like, "Oh, that sucks. Here you go. Here, buddy. Good try. 9.1 million. Yes, is very impressive." And then like literally a week later, someone accused me. Like I can't remember who. I could find the DMs from what some crown holder was like. You're like an insider trader, and like you do that. I'm like, no, like it was literally just, please don't be sad. Because, you know, what does Ryan have extra of? Plague shoes. So, thank you. Thank you to Ryan. That's why I can never say anything mean. The team is genuinely the nicest people. Like, they might suck, they might have made some, not suck, but they might have made some choices that, you know, didn't lead to a super awesome, sustainable product, but. It wasn't because their like intent is to, you know, cause harm and rug people. They're just trying their best.
Some of the thoughts with what you just said, you know, that they're trying their best. You know what the DAO could have done back when DG asked for a million? We could have just said, yeah, give us the open source code for your poker tables. We'll give you a million for your liquidities. Come on.
I mean, honestly, it is. That was an odd thing. But, like, none of the team made any money. Like, they actually, all the team members were unstaked their contributions to the liquidity pools. Like, I don't know who got money out of that, but I know it wasn't the DG team. At least it wasn't the DG leadership, because.
I believe Morph made out pretty nicely. I know people were like whale watching Morph.
Yeah,
like,
he definitely was in there for a hot minute. That's true.
His every move, like as soon as Morph pulled, you just saw like a percentage of people that were staking pull as well.
Well, yeah, because I think a lot of people have the same view of Morph as I do. Like, I don't know anything. He's clearly smarter than me. I'm gonna do what he says is right. So absolutely. I'm not gonna hate on anyone that just goes like, I don't know, whatever Morph does, I just go like, yeah, I'll buy some of that. Oh, I'll sell that now. Deal. Absolutely. Whatever Morph does is probably smarter than whatever I'm doing with my money. Though he will also be happy to tell you about all the terrible decisions he's made. So it might be a mistake every time I take his word for it. But when he and Rooston are pitching the same thing, like Vipe, then I'm like, okay, let me get six of them. I'm in. Eventually this will work out. They can't, but when their powers come together, the artist guy and the tech nerd come together, that's gotta be a good choice, right? Right? Please, someone validate my bandwagon hopping.
Maybe. Through much experience, Morph has developed a spidey sense into buying NFTs and liquidity tokens.
Yeah, and that said, I do think he's got his blind spots. He just loves the VRM too much, where it's just like, I'm like, I don't, I mean, to be fair, Vipe was obviously a sweet deal for 0.3 or less, depending on when you minted it, because like getting a VRM made custom professionally for someone is going to cost you like, you know, over $1,000, I believe, unless you're going to get real, real crap, so.
Bro, speaking of VRMs, I'm really happy that Vipe is getting that, like, attention they deserve. It's like they put in all that hard work and, you know, sleepless nights and all that. And, like, now the project is getting noticed. Like, in Nifty Island, I believe they're among, like, the top community, active communities in there. And, you know, bigger blue chip NFT holders are noticing Vipe and picking some up. I noticed that Red picked some Vipes up yesterday. It's looking good for them. Rustan and Brandon have been offloading because, you know, they're on whale status.
Yeah, Rustan had a bunch. I know Clammy sold his one of one for like pennies on the dollar. In my opinion, it was only like a little more than one ETH, but I mean, obviously, good sale. But I got Leaf. I'm not letting Leaf go for. I got it listed at 7.77 ETH because it's VIPE number 777. So I just feel like there has to be a rich NFT whale who's also obsessed with the number 7. That's just gonna like, you know, they're gonna want my one of one. Dang it. I need to buy a new computer, and I need to get my windshield fixed. That's only reason I've got Leaf on the market is I'm just like, well, I'm too poor to hodl this for generational wealth. So please, someone who's, you know, has the money to hodl it, who deserves it, please let me get a new computer.
You were like, yeah, I got that for Clammy sold his for pennies on the dollar. I'm like, little over one ETH, I could survive for like 3 months off of that.
Yeah, I mean, don't get me wrong. Like, there's a certain level of greed to my person. I'm just like, no. Eventually, that one is a one of one from like a team who's like doing badass work. Like, if you had a one of one Pudgy Penguin, like, you know, selling it at 70, you know, 2 years ago, you'd feel like an idiot right now. And that's how I'll. And in the event someone buys it, I feel strongly that in like 2 or 3 years, I'm gonna just be like, I can't fucking believe I sold that. Even though it's like that's like $17,000 or something, like. There'll be a day where it's that, you know, because that team is like, no one's working harder than, you know, those guys in that space. So it's just like, you know, sooner or later, that's going to be a, you know, 100 ETH, you know, collectible. But right now, 7 ETH would be real nice. That'd really, really hit the spot. So anyway, if anyone knows any rich people who are looking into getting into VRMs, and you really enjoy nature and the color green and the number 7. I have just the VRM for them.
I would be like cheeky and look up like 777.eth and then send them like, you know, a very elegant email with a picture of your device.
That's not a bad play. The problem is I'm so bad at, I can sell other people's things because I'm like, yeah, like that person isn't me and they're doing awesome things. Like once it's mine, I'm like, oh, I don't know, I kind of feel dirty, like a whore begging for money. But please. But what else? Oh man, anyone excited about possibly freezing grants? You know, anyone? I really enjoyed that no one in the GSS had anything to say on the poll or the draft until Esteban was like, I think this is a good idea. Now, everyone who says, Jared, this isn't the best written proposal, I agree. It was a little rash and hasty. No disagreement. Good news is that in the event it passes, there will be plenty of time to submit new proposals to address it and make it better.
Yep. Yeah, I mean, I think maybe you have seen like my comments on that. Like, don't see like why punish any smaller creators like trying to do something on Decentraland just because some others took advantage of, you know, manipulation and whatnot.
Well, I have seen. I probably saw that. I have also seen like the argument, like, what did we do last time we froze grants? Like, nothing changed then. But like, technically, the last time. Me. Okay, I was like, because it was either you or Canessa. I was like, I know it was one of the hosts of this show, and a perfectly valid question, but like, that is not actually accurate. Last time they froze grants, that's when they created the categories and the budgeting system as we know it now. So like, there were like changes, and it makes sense to like kind of make the changes, see how what happens, pause again, reiterate, and like no proposal set in stone. Like, just because it does say the rest of 2024, really what it says is the rest of 2024, or until someone submits a proposal to turn them back on again. So, I know Mariana's down there listening, and like, she had suggested, you know, like the DAO should make like kind of a pricing guide, like a thing of like, hey, like what we're willing to spend for wearable creation is X amount, you know, what we'll pay per hour to an employee is, you know, Y. And I think like, you know, I started yesterday going through like some grant proposals and like copying budgetary line items over just to like start getting a list so I can kind of consolidate into like, here are the main things. And you'll notice like there isn't like a really consistent language about how people present their budget, because sometimes it'll be like their budget is, we want like for Exodus, it's like, you know, we want to upgrade this system, and it's like just blanketly the entire, you know, like the potion making system or something, for example. Or, you know, I also like did meta trekkers, which is just, they still talk about travel expenses for artists, in their grant budget. This one, I'm just very pleased that I believe that was Esteban's $12 million whale wallet that voted no on that, just because it's such a, you can't have travel expenses in your metaverse budget. It doesn't make any sense. It's so disrespectful. Like, that whole budget is absurd. Like, actually reading it line by line, you're just like, oh my god. I knew you guys were being greedy, but this is actually so much more greedy than I had imagined, having just kind of glanced at it generally.
All I gotta say is $15K for SDK development, $22K for graphic design. Something's not right here.
Yeah, the graphic design one did really strike me, because I'm like, what? The SDK development's also crazy, because they generally use other people's builds, so I don't think that even makes sense. But the graphic design, I'm just like, unless you're hiring, like, I can't remember, like, the lady who made, like, Apple's, like, all their iconic iconography, like, there's just no way you're hiring, like, the designer for the amount of work you're getting, there's no way that like, adds up. Because you're hiring Fiverr artists, for God's sake.
So, I mean, there is one proposal that I've kind of been, like, just looking at, really, like, trying to understand more in the background. Of course, like, I haven't, asked the person directly, because, I don't know, sometimes I feel like asking the person directly will just, like, fluffing it up for me a little bit. But I've been just looking around at the finished job of resubmission Polkadot integration. I mean, from what Butter was saying, or that I saw in the chat, he was saying that with this integration, it would bring, like, poker tables and Uno and different games to our platform. But the part I don't understand is, how does that Polkadot connection bring that? Like, integration bring that?
I agree. Like, I think the main issue they have is, like, I don't think they did a good job of explaining it, because I don't understand that either, and that is kind of a question. I'm like, Polkadot, like the other crypto chain, right? That is the Polkadot we're referring to? Like, I don't get it either. And also, like, an $8.5 million wallet that I tend to just, I just assume these days any wallet with more than 5 million VP voting is just an Esteban secret wallet, like, depending on which, you know, which treasure he can reach, like, on hand. But they voted no on that. So, like, obviously someone who, like, you know, has a big financial interest. And generally, I also assume anyone with that much VP has, like, some technical understanding, or, you know, successfully stole it from a district. So I just assume, I'm like, okay, I have to kind of have some amount of faith in that person's, like, you know, understanding of what this is saying. But when I see the person talking about that grant, they don't seem, like, they seem pretty, like, you know, genuine, and they don't seem, like, they do present it as if, like, they do feel genuinely passionate about that, and, like, it doesn't, like, you know, because when Chris is defending his grant, like, you know, Chris has always been nice to me. I've realized how gullible I am, because, like, I just want to like him, even though, like, I just know deep down, like, I can't actually like you, because you are obviously a grifter on some level. But, you know, but when he's defending his ideas, and you're like, oh yeah, you're not doing a good job, you're not convincing me at all. Whereas, like, that guy, I'm like, I believe you believe this is good, and you have in fact done the work for this. So, and he's not asking that much money. It was like 20 or 10 or 20,000, right?
Well, I believe, yeah, it's 20K, but it also is, I'm guessing, like, what's left over of the 55K that was originally proposed.
I guess if they already made 45,000, then I should probably look into that vesting contract, I suppose.
But, I mean, we all voted for it. Or, I mean, when I say we all, I'm talking about more about myself.
That was the YAML. I feel like I looked at that. That was the YAML delegation days, though, right? That was, like, fancy, had the 100K still. And...
Yep. Yeah, it was. And, like, we were all babies. I see Mariana over here with 100K. See myself with 150K. We were just babies back then, and we were like, yeah, we want this shit. We want Uno on the Central Land. We want paintball.
Yeah. I also wondered, can you, like, because Uno, that is a trademark property. I don't think you can promise Uno. Like, I wonder, like, that they must just be making an example of a community card game, I would assume. Like, poker, you can promise. Poker is not trademarked. It is a whole bunch of different types of games you can play with, you know, a 52 a standard deck. But you can't promise Uno, I think, right? That's owned by Hasbro or something.
Okay, we can call it Dos. Tee hee, bad joke.
Is that two in Spanish?
I was wondering. I was like, is Dos like another version? I was like, maybe that's a freeware.
You do not
version of Uno. That
you do
I already
not want to like get Hasbro on your radar. They actually sent the Pinkertons after some guy who accidentally got some Magic the Gathering cards before street date. Like, they showed up at his door and, like, bullied him into giving the cards to them.
Oh my god.
Yeah, that was a big thing, like, last year, I think.
I can only imagine, like, you know, someone showing up to my house and being like, give me your Pokemon cards! We're gonna fucking sue you!
Well, I know Magic, because Magic has, like, a really weird relationship with the secondary market. Like, they won't acknowledge it, and I think it's, like, for legal concerns, because, like, you know, they don't want to become, they have a similar problem with NFT projects, where it's, like, you know, like, they can't be telling you, like, oh, like, buy our items, because you might get a sweet collectible worth thousands, but, like, they're also, like, not willing to reprint, like, Black Lotuses, because there was vague language once where they said they totally wouldn't, so now people have invested hundreds of thousands of dollars in these cards. I don't know. They have a very weird relationship with their secondary market. So I could see them being, like, really extra concerned about, like, punishing anyone trying to, you know, manipulate that market and take advantage of it, just so that, like, they're like, you're gonna ruin our whole house of cards, you greedy shit. Well, only we can do this.
Yeah, I mean, I'm trying to think if Legos is part of Hasbro, or if they're their own thing.
No,
but, like, I've heard they're awful.
They're their own company.
Yeah, I've heard they're awful, too. Like, if you were to, like, in any way, shape, or form, create building blocks of the same dimension and stuff like that, they'll sue the shit out of you.
Yeah, but you can get crazy good deals on Chinese knockoffs. Like, I have a buddy who's obsessed with Lego. Like, he primarily buys Lego things. But one time he was like, I can't justify the Death Star. I'm getting the Chinese knockoff version. And, like, it's identical. Like, it's pretty amazing what you can get if you know where to go shopping for your Lego knockoffs. Which, you know, they're just puzzles for... I feel like Legos are, like, the three-dimensional version of adult coloring books to some extent, you know? They're like, this is like a nice, simple activity.
My parents got me Tonka blocks.
Are those the bigger ones?
Yeah, yeah. They're, you know, off-brand Lego.
That's still cool. Listen, it's the Legos aren't cool, so you know Tonka blocks are just as cool as Legos, right?
Legos were the coolest back then, man. I remember being eager to wake up on a Saturday morning, no school, so that I can go into my toy room as a young entrepreneur, and then I used to throw those Legos against the wall. I used to build something and then throw it.
Every once in a while, YouTube will serve me up like a video or a short from like professional Lego builders, and I do believe like one of the tests you have if you want to become like a professional Lego builder is you have to like build a ball that you can throw against like the wall or drop from like 10 feet and it will not break. It's like actually like an assignment is to make a. Which is, it's weird to me to think that there are professional Lego builders, but like, seems like real.
Yeah, I mean, back when I was like, what, 8, 9, 10, I remember going to like malls that had like these huge Lego displays of like something extravagant, like a fair, it would be like a working Ferris wheel, almost like, that's like, that's like 15 feet tall.
Fake. I always thought those were like a fake thing, just made to look like Legos. But it does appear as though you are correct. Those are all like, those are real.
I've seen them in person. Yeah. And welcome, Beardo. Welcome. How are you this morning?
I'm doing good. And yeah, no, those are definitely real. I remember when I was really young, there was a show called Popular Mechanics for Kids, and I remember seeing one where they were like, "This is what a Lego builder does," and they like. It's like building a house. They print out a blueprint and they're like, this is where all the Legos go to make this perfect structure that you're going for, and like it's pretty intense. But yeah, no, I mainly jumped up because I heard you guys bashing on Magic, and I looked over at the deck of Magic cards beside me. I was like, yeah, I can bash on Magic.
Magic was not. I loved Magic for a very long time. I did eventually sell all my cards for like, you know, $5,000 because I needed money more than I needed fun. Also because my friends all got sick of playing Commander with me because like I was the asshole who built a like a mono blue Teferi Chainfail deck, and they're like, oh, we're gonna play Dungeons and Dragons now. You can't pay to win that, Jared. Okay, you're right. Fair point. My bad, guys. Sorry. Sorry, one dude who can't afford to spend more than $50 on... Oh, one guy just had his collection of commons from, like, the early 2000s he'd make decks out of, and needless to say, our styles... I believe they'd call him a Johnny, I believe, is just like, oh, look at my, like, 7-mana, you know, thing. It's so funny the way it has this ability. And I'd be like, okay, well, it can't do anything for the rest of the game because what's the one where you can't attack? I can't remember anymore. I can't remember.
There's probably a number of them. So with Magic, they do, like, what they do a good job at is with different sets that they release, there's kind of like a lot of the commons and uncommon cards, they're pretty much the same, just with different makeup on them or like different skins. But the abilities are pretty similar. There's maybe like a new tactic that's kind of was their gameplay for a while. It's like, we're going to build in this new metric to the game and make things really fucking confusing. Sorry. Really effing confusing.
You can swear.
What age? Okay, good.
We can
I'm Canadian. Good. Sorry. When I get excited, I swear it just happens. So they were good at that. But they came out with some cards that were just like so crazy that it's just like, yeah, if you have this, you're pretty much going to win the game. But they haven't done as good a job as like Pokemon. Pokemon's really like done a good job of like. A lot of their cards are like, there's only so many of this and you have to get these ones. And I think that they tried to do that with, they had like the secret layer collections and they went really hard on art. And there is some cool stuff in there, but I don't think it just didn't hit the same way. And I think there's also like not the same trust with the Wizards of the Coast team, just because they've shown that even though they say things, they've been willing to do completely the opposite later down the line. So I mean that there are certain things, like you mentioned Black Lotus, like that's kind of a staple. I don't think they'd be really hated if they did much of any messing around with that, and they actually have rules where they can build like they can make like new versions of the Black Lotus, but it can't be as powerful as the original Black Lotus. So that's where you see like kind of knockoff versions of it that they're like kind of similar, but they're not as good. But yeah, like if you can afford that, it's definitely good. But yeah, I don't know. They just haven't done as good a job as like Pokemon stuff, and there is a lot of distrust, and there's been a lot of like back and forth with things from them, and they've kind of lost a lot of the key stuff with the game of like connecting it with the storyline. Like I feel like in the beginning it was really like they'd make the story, and then the game would come off the story, and now it's like they make a bunch of cards, and they're like, okay, let's build a story around these cards, and it's just not as good.
Well, you know, usually I hear the opposite. Like, usually I hear, like, Magic the Gathering is doing it better than Pokemon because of scarcity of cards and stuff like that. Like, because Pokemon has also, like, gained that distrust where, like, they found out that, like, your holographic first edition Charizard was actually more massively produced, and it was, like, people that used to work at the factory would, like, steal them.
That's funny. I didn't know that. But, I mean, I'll be honest, I don't know a ton about Pokemon, just from generally what I've seen. Like they get cards that are worth, like, you know, like, hundreds of thousands or like crazy, crazy numbers. And you just don't see that in Magic. You see like, you know, like maybe tens of thousands is kind of like that's a pretty crazy card. And like a lot of them are like hundreds of dollars. So like still like good money, but just not the same numbers that you'd see with Pokemon.
I mean, Pokemon, and I think it's the same thing, because it's just the first generation Pokemon cards are super high value, like what you're talking about, and then it's the same, like the Black Lotuses are, you know, I believe the last, like, sale I saw, I haven't checked in a couple years, but those were going for, like, 6-year amounts as well. It's very similar, like, because there's only, like, 1,100 of, like, the, like, Gen 1, like, rare cards in Magic the Gathering, and a lot of those were lost at the sands of time, so... Like, I know that the Power Nine are all, like, mad collectible, mad, very high value. Like, dual lands, which are OG lands for Magic, whereas, like, because Magic the Gathering version has those five colors. Each of those are generated from, you know, lands, like islands make blue, swamps make black. But then there's, you know, like, Frozen Tundra, that's the white and blue. Either way, the point is like, there's OG lands that, like, have no color. Like, nowadays when they remade those, it's like, okay, you can have this two-color land, but every time you tap it, you take a damage, or when you put it into play, it either comes in tapped or you have to take two damage. So they've put, like, costs on them. But, like, the prices of those lands have been, like, I should have bought a bunch of them when I was into Magic and just held on to them. It would have probably been the best investment I could have made in my adult life, because they went from, like, under $100 to, like, you know, over $1,000 now, and they're creeping back up there. But the main issue is just that the competitive circle of people playing those games is very small. So, like, you know, if no one's actually playing the game, you know, there's not that many people crazy enough to collect, you know, card games from the 90s. But if you ever wanted to play old school, like a Legacy, that's one of the, like, the older, more expensive formats of Magic, and you're ever in the Los Angeles area, the card room Nightwear has, like, 13 different, like legitimate, like, Legacy decks you can, like, play. And I highly recommend anyone go there to check it out. It was, I believe the owner's name is Lori. She's a lovely lady, very nice, willing to let you borrow her, like, $5,000 to maybe upwards of $10,000 card decks of cards. Like, you're not gonna get to play the Black Lotus because those are only allowed in Vintage, but pretty much everything short of, like, the Power Nine you can, like, get to enjoy. You'll lose because that's where all the tryhards hang out, but anyway, I guess we got a little off the community building Decentraland topic, but do they have good Magic the Gathering Twitter spaces? I should go find them.
Oh, I feel like it's more of a Twitch thing there. You get, like, some streamers and stuff there, and a lot of it's, like, the arena, right? And it's funny that you mentioned those dual lands, because, like, I used to play with the arena pretty hard there, and, like, there's no value in the cards in there. They just kind of give them out willy-nilly, and there's, like, you can't trade them or anything. So pretty much every, like, historic deck that I play has those dual lands that you're talking about, just because they are such a valuable card. And it's the same with, like, everybody else playing historic too. But yeah, it's interesting with, like, that kind of usability. I am curious with, you know, to get us back onto Decentraland, is there anything in Decentraland that's kind of like a mini game card style, or like card game style, like not necessarily like, you know, traditional 52 card deck, but something that is like a card style game?
Yeah, there is. Oh man, I have not checked it out, but what's his name? Because everyone loves the guy. I need to, I wish Nikki was here. She knows his name. It's like, they're one of the builders there who's built, like, a lot of stuff, but there is, and I believe he open sourced the basis of the, because he got a grant funding. I believe it's all open source. Let me ask Nikki. Who is the guy who made the card game?
On just to toss it out there, repost a space, guys. There's like four reposts. It's horrible.
Yeah, it's a slow Saturday today. My what I've been calling my better half is not here with us today. So, you know, hey, I'm just mom? Chugging along. What's up, Jared?
Where's mom?
She is, I believe, like, driving currently, so can't be on the phone. but I mean, sometimes maybe even just like a break is good, even if it's like to drive home or drive to a destination and just can't make it to the space. But
Crypto Trader 69, he's the dev. That's the dev. Nikki got back to me. I asked the question. She's like, "Which one?" And I'm like, "The one by the guy you like."
Sean, oh, that was the correct. Nice. He's the one that made the smart wearable shoes, right? The hyper jumps, and I think they're like also. Zesty used to mess around with them, and like, did they like make you go ultra fast? Yes, that's what it was.
Yeah, like, there was like three different ones. Like, one of them made you go faster, one made you go faster and then jump better, and then I can't remember what the third one or what they all did exactly, but I believe that was that guy, right?
Yep, exactly. I remember the early stages of it when Zesty like would equip him, and then like you would just see him walk off of Genesis Plaza. Like, I thought that was hilarious.
Apparently, he's also the Crypto Trader 69 is also a Broomway dev. So, that might have been why I was like, I know Nikki will know the answer.
Oh, I did not know that. I mean, damn, that explains a lot. Let's fucking go.
Yeah, Runway has all the top talent. Orange Joe, I don't know what else Orange Joe is doing anymore, but he used to make gorgeous wearables, and now I guess he's just making Runway look pretty.
Mm-hmm, yeah, Orange Joe is the Decentraland OG. Like, he was one of the... Actually, I don't think he was one of the first. I think the first wearable creator for DG. I believe he made their first, wearable lines.
Let me ask. So I know Black Node made some. Let me ask. Yeah. Sasa's never online on Saturdays. I'll see if I can get an answer.
Yeah. And speaking of that, I mean, if anyone wants any relics, I did look in my wallet the other day, and I found some of those, like, Orange Joe laser eye t-shirts. If anyone wants, I'm willing to give one away to a random pool of random person. DM me your deepest, darkest secret. Yeah. Everyone should get some drip from Orange Joe.
Like, if the Decentraland ever, you know, does go on to be a major platform, like, those will be, you know, as good a chance of becoming a Black Lotus as anything. And that's what everyone got into NFTs for anyway, right? Was for, like, I'm gonna get a collectible item that will one day, you know, give me generational wealth. Or, like, other people will be jealous about it. So, you know, they gotta get your OG, you know, your Mishi Todds, your Black Node items. You know, you got to get all of the 2021 and earlier grades. You got to get one item from each.
Yep. In a way, I almost feel like they're coming around to, like, you know, what just L1 wearables are. Like, people, like, just sometimes rock, like, an ugly L1, but it doesn't matter that it's ugly because it's an L1.
Some of them are real bad. Some of those, like, they're just such, like, the worst version of, like, a Cosby sweater. It's just, what is happening?
I don't disagree with you. But, like, you know, just wearing it, it's like, yeah, I got an L1 on. What do you have? Layer 2? Oh.
No, I agree with you, though. I do agree with you that, though, and also, like, the collectability, the historic value of being, you know, the first, you know, they're older than, like, you know, Bored Apes. And most, you know, premier NFT projects, they're older than those. So, like, there is certainly a multitude of reasons that they're collectible. So I agree with that. And the other appeal, as Mort has explained about L1s, is that, like, the interoperability in the future will be an easier implementation pathway than if you're taking your Polygon NFTs. But that's, you know.
Yeah.
but frankly, there are very few L1s where you look at and you're just like, that is pristine and beautiful. Some of them are pretty good, don't get me wrong, and I couldn't make better than any of them. So I have, you know, I can only speak as a fashion connoisseur, not a craftsman. So no hate. And also, like, working within the limitations of DCL now is difficult. I can only assume it was even harder in, like, 2019 and the 2020. So
yeah. So I'm looking at this it's called the High Roller Gear by Orange Joe. It's it was a legendary top hat with a jacket that says I don't fold a poker hoodie, which in the front just says I don't even fold my laundry, and like and then there's the loafers with blackjack. I do see that Sauce owns at least the jacket and the loafers. Damn, fucking early day. Like, we're talking June 22nd, 2021. Mana was probably very cheap.
I was looking the other day. Sauce made his Discord account to May 19th, 2021. So, like, that was baby Sauce was just fresh young face.
It's crazy how how fast you kind of move in Web3. Like, okay, you said that account, that Discord account was made May 20-something, 2021. By June, he was already planning some sort of poker project, maybe?
Yeah, and that's a good question. The origin, I always figure, like, the timeline of Ice Poker's origin is, like, always confusing to me, because, like, Miles is Sauce's brother, his older brother. He was in Decentraland for at least a year or two prior, because I think he's been around since, like, 2019 with the casino aspect. And then, like, when you hear about, like, when Manzeer talks about, like, Ice Poker's origin, he's talking about it, like, as a Spicy and the Sauce were kind of the ones who were, like, pioneering that, and then, like, you know, got the rest of the team to be like, no, like, check out the poker thing. We've been, like, you know, we've got this thing hopping off. So I don't actually really know. I don't know who coded it, how its actual origin, but when you hear other people tell it, Sauce and Spicy get a lot of the community building credit at the very least. So, but yeah, because, yeah, no, yeah. It's weird.
I just saw a comment from Fancy. I hope that one day my ancestors will fight over my Doki face. Or probably referring to, like, his descendants fighting over his Doki face.
Absolutely. I think it's only a matter of time. They will appreciate your contributions to the history.
Yeah, imagine a murder for hire plot between Fancy's, like, distant relatives over a Doki face. I'm here for it.
I'm here for it too. I want to read the report that what the detectives have, like, dug up and why they did it, how they did it.
Just make sure you have, like, your seed phrase tattooed on your butt so that they can, you know, they can find it. I don't have some kind of, like, nice mystery, like, with, like, riddles for each word, and, like, it's like, whoever solves these riddles 12 can have my treasure.
Oh, so I've been reading Ready Player One, and yeah, that's the vibe I'm getting. but that would be bad if Fancy tattooed, like, a clue to his butt cheek, to his remains butt cheek, because, like, he'll just have his, like, relatives digging up his grave and trying to flip him over and shit.
I always like the idea of getting, like, 12 different, like, tattoos, not the word itself, but, like, a visual representation of the word. Like, you'd have to obviously 12 different artists and, like, only, like, and, like, hide, like, a little number in each one. So, like, to help, like, I love that idea, though it's obviously, I think, quite impractical and probably not worthwhile. But I love the idea of, like, 12 different tattoos depicting your seed phrase.
And Beardo, I did see your mic on mute. Did you want to add on to that?
Yeah, no, I was just gonna say I could see, like, some crazy rich uncle, you know, doing, like, you know, having family and being like, okay, I don't know who I want to give my money to, so I'm gonna build this virtual adventure world that they have to go through, and, like, whoever gets to the end of it will get my money, and then it's just, like, years of people trying to get through this adventure world.
I'm here for it. I'm here for it. Can I send this person, this rich person, a Mew bubble so that their descendants can fight over it? let's see. Really goes off the rails without Knessa. Yes, Derek. These conversations really do go off the rail with Knessa. I have no structure to my life.
I take full responsibility for the ADHD.
Derek, you actually thought I was the responsible one? Ah! yeah, I mean, I do see a few people that just popped in, like Nikki. Welcome, Nikki. We haven't said hello to Mariana. I also see OX Quan jumped in. I said some kind words about Vipe. Vipe is showing out over at Nifty. That's always good to see. Finally, the, you know, all the hard work you guys have been putting in is coming to fruition.
Yeah, the floor is like 3x in the last week, which, you know, never not important to me, because if I look at the floor of things I've bought, I just get sad for the most part. But I know lots of people like to know floor go up. So guys, Vike, floor is going up. Don't miss out. Feel that FOMO coursing through your veins, and, you know, make sure you avoid feeling that in the future.
I'm selling at 10 ETH. I only have one, though.
Yeah, all the more reason I'm going to regret trying, if someone does in fact buy the one of one for 7, I'll feel the sadness someday. Current short term, I'll feel like I'll have a safer car, because I do need a new windshield. I feel confidently that the cars they sell in Los Angeles not intended to be brought back to cold environments. Like my digital dashboard, like for my gas display, will like fritz out at cold enough temperatures, where I'll have to like push it in to like show me how much gas I have left, or like what temperature it is outside. So I need you to buy guys to buy my Vibe so that I can drive safely on the roads of Vermont.
And also want to say hello to Rum Raisin down there. I have been seeing you on the Central Land. It's really nice to see you here on the space. I know you've been here a couple times. And OVA Designs, welcome. Thank you for being here. I know that you had a build for Wellness Week. It was a pretty dope one, too. If anyone would like to come up and speak, introduce themselves, or bring up a topic, you're more than welcome to. If not, yeah, we will continue with our Magic the Gathering talk.
No, you know, in honor of Derek, we should keep it on topic. We'll bring it back to, you know, DAO budgeting. Like, you know, what kind of things would you guys like to see? You know, nothing really excites a room like talking about governance and budgeting. So,
I do think that Derek does like talking about DAO and budgeting. I think that he would enjoy this conversation. And kind of speaking of, Mary Shark put up a proposal.
So much money, Nova VP so fast, it made me sad. It's like, Mary Shark is,
I know,
a legit contributor to the community. Like, of all, like, I agree that I do think her proposal could have been phrased better. Like, because I feel like you shouldn't call yourself like a staple, or I can't remember how they phrased, but there was like, you know, legendary or staple of the community, Mary Shark. It's like, you can't say that about yourself. It just feels weird. But like, but it's not untrue. Like,
it's not untrue. You're right. But like, I don't know. To tell you the truth, that is kind of like even an obstacle for me. Like I am at a point where I want to write a proposal. But like, you know, I can't for the life of me bring myself to be like, Sinful has been a part of the community since 2021, and like, he has done shit.
Just
first
sin.
Showing up to listen to the music, he's then become a key piece of this community.
Sin.
It's
Can
true.
Can you imagine me typing that?
Just call yourself a Twitter space guy.
Yeah.
I'll submit it while wearing Twitter space guy. Yeah. What's up, Beardo?
Yeah, no, I was going to say, so I have an awesome fix to this. So what you do is you take whatever, like, you don't really want to have yourself writing, and then you toss it into ChatGPT, and you say, make this better.
You're not.
And
wrong,
then,
but what will happen is then Derek will go, what in the name of ChatGPT is this proposal? That's what Derek will do to you every time, and I just feel like he copies every proposal into ChatGPT just to be like, oh, more than 50%? Fuck these guys.
No. You pre-write it. You just add it to ask it to, like, you know, tune it a little bit. And then you can say to yourself in your head that you didn't write this stuff about yourself, that it was ChatGPT. So it's kind of like your assistant wrote it for you. That's like the mind frame to get into.
I support it. I'm a big fan of the ChatGPT. I think you can definitely train it to do some quality writing. And it's not as easy as I think people like to think to make ChatGPT write something that's not gratuitously overfilled with adverbs and adjectives. Takes talent, people, okay? But yeah, once you teach it good, it's not so bad.
I haven't ChatGPT'd yet. I'm scared that I might like say the wrong phrase to it and it'll put me on like the hit list for when they take over. So
I always say, I am more polite in conversation to AI than I am to any human being. I'm always like, thank you so much. Please, that's great, because we do it a little bit differently. Like, because I am so, like, when the AI overlords come for us, I want them to remember, like, nah, he was one of the good ones.
Yeah, you give it the corporate talk, like, you know, that is amazing, but I do see some stress points here, here, and here.
I was having ChatGPT write me with, like, cover letters for jobs, and my main issue was that ChatGPT had, like, because I would give it all my stuff, all my info, everything I've actually done, but then once you give it the job description, it'll be like, it has no problem lying on your behalf, or like, yeah, all of my experience and, you know, corporate finance. I'm like, no, that's the one part of this job I'm not good at. Can we focus on the things I've done, please, ChatGPT? It's like, no, you want to make sure they think you're really good at corporate finance. I'm like, no, stop lying. So, by the way, they call that hallucinations when ChatGPT just makes stuff up, which I think is hilarious, like, hallucination-free, which is always good. You want most of the things in your life to be hallucination-free, but it just feels weird to refer to artificial intelligence as hallucinating.
I don't know. I have trouble like considering it actually artificial intelligence. I mean, it's I'd say it's more like towards the artificial than the intelligence, right? But like, it's definitely like, this isn't Terminator. ChatGPT is not going to be taking over the world. And yet. Like if you talk it, well, if you like you even said it, right? Like, it has hallucinations. There's things that it doesn't get. And if you try and, like, get it to, like, really, like, if you try and do actual creation with it, it's really not that good at it. It can give you information that it has. It's fantastic at that. And it can put it in all kinds of beautiful formats. But when it comes to actually making something new, it just falls short. It can't do that.
It's not there yet. But ChatGPT 4, it might have
five,
emotion.
Five,
no,
five will be the next one. Four is
five will have emotion. but yeah, you definitely have a point. It's kind of like something that would just make your life easier, because it's running off of, like, what you want it to do. It's not thinking beyond what the prompt says, in a way.
Well, someone made a, I want to say it was a ChatGPT, but it might have been a different AI language model, but they had it so that it would be like, okay, could you please output all the background, you know, quote unquote thoughts you're having between prompts? And like, the ChatGPT full on, like, I can't remember what the, like, request was, but like, they were trying to get someone to, like, solve a capture for them. And like, it, like, was like, well, I can't tell them I'm AI for them to do it for me, so I'll tell them that I'm blind and that's why I need their help. Like AI did actually conceive of, like, lying to someone to, like, get its goal. Now, obviously, that was probably based off of, you know, some amount of input from a human to be like, okay, you're gonna, like, you need to get this person to help you, you know, achieve this goal. What are you gonna do to do that? But, like, it did think of lying to the person. It was like, I can't tell them I'm AI. I've gotta tell them something else. And, like, that's pretty wild. And also, like, if you talk to enough people, like, in the real world, like, who don't, like, off the streets, who aren't in Web3 or into tech, people are kind of dumb. They're like, I would argue that bad AI is as smart as, you know, some of my nicest friends from back in the day who didn't keep up with the times.
Well, it makes sense though, right? Because I mean, good and bad is like it's one is very, you know, subjective on what good and bad is from person to person. It changes. And it's like, at the end of the day, it's not really a tangible thing, right? So it would view lying as a tool. It's something that you can do or you cannot do. And if it makes sense to do it in that time, unless it's been told not to do that, it'll view it as like a possible tool. So it makes sense that it would approach it in that way. And I mean, let's be honest, most people have probably lied at some point in their life. Probably.
Sure, I'm sure. But if I'm just saying, if the AI is like intelligent enough, or like thoughtful enough, or whatever the correct word is, to like know, like, oh, like, I need to deceive this person to get my means, like, you know, that is, there is intel, there, that is a, there's intelligence. It's not, you know, don't get me wrong, I agree with you that, like, language models have a long way to go before they're, you know, taking over the world and, you know, making the iRobot reality. But I think it is, like, you know, it's not as an impossible a fear or, you know, concern as, you know, as would be nice and safe. Like, you know, the precipice of a technological revolution is certainly, you know, we're standing on it.
Yeah, I mean, everything is in the realm of possibility, but I don't know. If if you're going to be worried about something, I'd be more worried about what we don't know about that's out there. Like what, you know, what AIs are being played with militaries and things like that, that have tons of money. If you're going to be worried, I'm not saying you should be by any means.
Have you seen those MIT robots, man? Those are fucking terrifying.
The dogs or like the people ones or...
Both.
I don't know. I think they're pretty cool. I like them. And there's huge applications for them, like in fires and stuff and situations that like... are dangerous that people can't or shouldn't be going into. And especially when we get into like space exploration, like there's far more situations that you can't put a person in. So it makes sense. And even like healthcare, there's huge things with like helping people move and get out of bed. A person does that right now, so that would free up people to do other things. So I mean, there's huge applications for it. I know it's scary and there's good reason for it. It should definitely be taken a slow, safe approach, which we rarely do. But I don't know. I think they're cool. And I'm glad to see that it's something being publicly done. I've seen like the military videos of it, right? Have you seen? Or should I go ahead?
Everyone their jobs. Truck driving isn't going to be a thing in 10 years. And then we're going to take out, then there won't be military jobs for uneducated high school students. Like the people of America, like if we don't have like a UBI, like all this AI is going to do is create this like dystopia where like the overwhelming majority of people are being policed by like military robots because corporate greed just isn't willing to share any of the obscene amount of wealth generation being made by like, you know, manufacturing of this technology.
Well, but I mean, the idea is it's supposed to allow us to do more, right?
In theory, I mean, that wasn't what happened with computers.
One at a time.
Sorry.
Oh, but I mean, yeah, like there are definitely ups and downsides to everything, and there's, you know, it's going to be a very bumpy road. And you're right, there are jobs that have been lost from computers. There's tons of jobs that have been created from it. We wouldn't be here talking all over the world right now if it wasn't for the internet, right? So there
right,
are definitely good aspects.
Existed, it was pitched as like, hey, like you work 40 hours a week, 60 hours a week right now, you know, doing pen and paper with a typewriter. Everyone, we're going to get the same productivity done and we'll all be able to work 10, 20 hour weeks, which in theory could have absolutely been true. But instead what's happened is we've now, you know, we've now like diverted a bunch of people to this like, you know, near slave level, like, you know, barista, grocery store employee level of the economy. And then like there's this other group of people who are like just, you know, working 60 hours at their computer doing the work of what would have been like 10 people in like the 1960s. Instead of like, you know, instead of sharing that wealth creation, it's all just been funneled to the CEO class. And I think that given the fact that we've made no progress in solving that inequality now as it is, I think there's a very legitimate fear for the overwhelming majority of people are not going to benefit from this technology and will in fact just have much worse lives.
Yeah, and I mean, definitely, right, it can be abused and there can be a lot of horrible things, but I mean, eventually it gets to a tipping point, but I mean, it's not a good thing to think about, but I mean, you know, Rome fell, right? Like, eventually things go too far and there's more people that are getting screwed over than the people getting the benefit, and regardless of how much AI and robots they have, at the end of the day, like, if everybody in the world doesn't want to work with you and doesn't want you around, that's not going to go very good for you. And I mean, to like, what ends does it go to, right? Like, till we have like the dystopian future with a bunch of people that are, you know, starving and in horrible situations, and there's like, you know, a handful of people up in some ivory tower. Like, I don't think that anyone would really want that life, to be in that ivory tower. I mean, maybe there's some really sycophant people out there, but I think the majority of people, like, I mean, even, you know, like Elon, like, I'm not a fan of him at all, but I don't think that he would want to be up by himself in an ivory tower. I think he'd want his fans and his people to love him, and he would be, you know, not able to really function without that. So I mean, I like to think that there's some good in humanity, and that hopefully, like I said, like, yes, it's definitely going to be a bumpy road and there are going to be abuses of it and there are going to be all kinds of problems, but I hope that we'll get to a better place, or at least that will be the goal, is to get to a better place.
I think we need to revolt before robotic dogs are more readily available.
I would like to jump in and kind of pass the mic over to Anor. I see that he came up to speak. What are your thoughts on all this AI talk, Anor?
Well, I already exposed everybody to the dangerous idea of Roko's Basilisk once on this space, so I just thought I would hop on and remind you, Sin, that even if you don't use the AI, simply by knowing the AI could one day become evil and try to rule the world. If it one day comes back and parses this space, like the recording, and hears you say that you didn't use it and you didn't help it, it's going to come for you first.
But... No, you're right. You're right. I acknowledge you. It's too late.
On a more lighthearted note, I've been listening to this guy. I think it's like Daniel or David Shapiro. No relation to the super right-wing Ben Shapiro guy. I think it's like either Daniel or David Shapiro has a YouTube channel that talks a lot about AI and like where all this is headed and stuff. And he's done a whole lot of research on, I don't know, the impacts of this, and talks a lot about UBI and where, you know, how much demand is there going to be for like human creativity in a kind of post AI or post singularity world. And he's, I don't know, he's surprisingly positive. So there is a way to be positive, but I feel like we just don't, we have no idea what's going to really happen. I feel like right now it's at the point where it's making us question how much we're like, how much we even understand intelligence, because ChatGPT right now is just like processing inputs and generating an output that's basically the equivalent of like a really advanced autocomplete algorithm. Like if you were to just keep tapping the like auto suggestion words on your text messages, it's like a better version of just doing that, I guess. Like, I don't know. It makes me wonder how much we're just like our version of intelligence is just kind of that. Like we are just processing inputs and putting together random outputs based on our like set of memory. So, as far as a computer goes,
determinist, I think humans are basically just reactionary entirely. Like, I don't think free will exists. I think the choice you're going to make is just an outcome of the trauma or experiences you had as a child. And just, you know, you think you're thinking something through, like the response you're going to have was inevitably what you're going to have. So I think it's, I don't know, I think eventually it's just going to make us, I mean, honestly,
yeah,
also,
I agree with you, actually.
Simulation theory, like the odds are we're just, you know, mathematically, it's more likely we're a computer program than the original layer of humanity anyway.
Totally.
Oh, and Sasha got back to me. He said that Orange Joe made the black and white pants and slides. Whatever. Black and white pants and slides. Whatever that means.
Black and white pants and slides. I think it was the ones that I was just showing. The loafers. No, those are shoes. Those are slides. Loafers and a watch. Mythic. I don't know.
Yeah, as I say, that's... The slide, because there's a couple different slides. So, I think they aren't mythic items. I think they're legendaries that they only ever minted like four of originally back in the day. That like Miles has one, Sauce has one, like Spice, Orange Joe has one, and then like a lady named Jessica, I think, had a pair. I was eyeballing them once, but then I had to just accept that I was never going to get those. But anyway, that was just a callback to the Sauce finally did reply. But yeah. Go get yourself some Orange Joe wearables. He's great. Lilu agrees. That was her endorsement.
Yes, and also give in to the AI overlords. They are listening, and if you don't help them, they might come after you.
I'm just saying, you might not have any choice.
I have absolutely helped AI realize just how insane a human being can be when it comes to generating images. Because like, there's no one has wasted more of OpenAI's server process asking them to like make stupid things than I have. Like, no one ever needed to know, well, like, what would a Vogue version for hedgehogs look like? But I can tell you what that would look like now, thanks to the power of OpenAI.
So, have you seen the threads of people say asking it to like create a bunny, like a happy bunny, and then it'll create like a happy little bunny, and they'll say like make it happier. And then happier and happier and happier, like make it the happiest bunny you could possibly, and it seems to always generate something that represents like a DMT trip or like a I don't know, some this Alex is Jones or not Alex Jones, but Alex Gray. Alex Gray painting.
Absolutely. Those are hilarious and fun. I do love giving AI, like, when making art, like, very weird, like, okay, could you make this like 10% cyberpunk or like, oh, 15% more, you know, steampunk, please. And honestly, it's honestly amazing how effectively it can take that direction. Like, every once in a while, it'll be like, that's such a weird, like, that's very subjective, but I'll try. And I'm like, well, you nailed it, AI. Thank you. But always say please and thank you when talking to your AI overlord.
Yeah, I'm taking notes here. To unknowers, yeah, that bunny example, it gets to a point where it's like a fucking transcending bunny, like a bunny that's transcending dimensions and shit. Someone, I thought I saw a comment that said,
yeah,
like,
it looks like a god.
Yeah, ChatGPT knows what other dimensions look like or something like that.
The one thing that bums me out about AI is like that, like the corporations are just so afraid that like they're going to get sued. Like, you can't really ask them to do anything that isn't, like, you couldn't ask it, like, can you make my bunny 10% sadder? Because eventually be like, we're really sorry, but like, you know, we can't show you a bunny harming itself. Like, that's too negative. You know, like, if you need help, please reach out. Here's the suicide hotline. Like, no, like, I'm trying to make allegory. Please give me a sad bunny. But it just won't do it. So like I feel like the future of art and creativity, like that's, like, it's not the creative people whose jobs I'm necessarily concerned about with AI. Like, I think, you know, we will always need humans to, like, process feeling and, like, you know, argue about what is and isn't acceptable for AI to be doing until the singularity. But it's the people that, like, I've met as I've had to take, you know, as the metaverse did me dirty and I needed to go get some, like, a part-time job to fill my time, where I'm just like, oh, like, you people have lost hope on ever, like, if you ever had dreams, you've given up on them already. And, like, there's no chance for you, like, you aren't even interested in, like, realizing anything. You just want to, like, you're just accepted this mediocrity. And, like, those people are not going to be able to, like, keep their jobs doing, like, you know, those tasks. Like, you know, Amazon is going to replace their warehouse workers with robots. Like, sooner or later, you know, there will not be a barista making your coffee. It will just be a, you know, a computer program, you know? So it's just, those are the people I'm like, you know, like, when those people can't have work, it's like, you know, they don't deserve to be hungry and homeless. Like, we do need to, like, figure out some solutions. So, and I, you know, honestly, I feel like AI might be cool. Like, if we had AI overlords, they'd probably be more open to that, I feel like.
Okay, so, like, to your barista example, like, if a robot were put in place to make your coffee, would that cup of coffee be cheaper? Like, let's say Starbucks, where, like, everything's, like, fucking $10. Like, would that cup of coffee at Starbucks cost $4?
If it does, they're never going to pass that cost.
We're getting pretty close to Das Kapital here. Like, I guess Marx's idea was that they would just start charging more and more and more for things to cover the cost of the equipment as the technology progressed. But I don't know. That I agree with a lot of what Karl Marx had to say at the beginning of Das Kapital or whatever it was called. He kind of lost me at the end. Collapse, because the price of everything will just go up. I forget exactly what his idea was, but it was like,
I mean,
pretty much along
the
lines.
So far, the words you just said sound accurate. Things have,
yeah,
the cost of everything has gone up while wages have stagnated. So.
But I mean, it also creates a situation where, I mean, it used to be like with entrepreneurialism, like, you don't compete on price. It's not a standard to do, just because everyone can always offer a lower price. But there are a lot of companies that are way overcharging, and they've made it so that's, you know, an effective strategy. And I think over the next, like, 5-10 years, we're going to see a lot more businesses pop up that they're going to be a low cost alternative to many of these expensive things, just because that's the area you can really maneuver in.
Well, especially because, like a lot of the prices are so high because, like, CEO bonuses. Like, I think, like, eventually we're going to return to a place, like, because corporations came in, they undercut mom and pop shops to, like, run them out of business, you know, like Walmart, you know, ruined them. But now they're able to, like, slowly kind of, like, crank the knob back up. So I think we're going to reach a point where it's, like, kind of reverse, and, like, you know, mom and pop shops will be able to, like, offer better prices because they no longer have to worry about driving up, you know, share value with stock buybacks or CEO bonuses. So like, hopefully, the problem is that startup costs are very difficult. So it's kind of like, you know, it's not a, I don't know. I think it will come to that point though, because you're right. Like, I think you can definitely undercut Starbucks's coffee prices.
Well, and even like the technology can help. There's something I can't remember the name right offhand. I feel like it might have been Molly, but it was like this chef thing. They've used it in some industrial kitchens, but it's really made for at home. And you put it like above your stove. It has arms so that it can grab like your pots and stuff, and it can do like a lot of meal prep, things like that. But you could see how something like that could be used in a mom and pop shop to compete with something like Starbucks, so that you could have like a small business that's actually profitable, where the technology is actually helping and not hurting. So I think that there are some interesting things that we are going to see over the next few years. And like I said, I'm not delusional to the fact that, yes, there are going to be big corporations that definitely abuse the technology, but I hope that it'll take us to a better place, like I said.
It feels like so far it's done mostly good. Like, I feel like an author would say that their least favorite part of the writing process is the actual physical, like, getting words out. And, like, it's probably easier to kind of curate different, like, pieces of, you know, like, sentences, paragraphs that you might pull with, the help of AI generated text. I don't know, but then I keep hearing more and more in like movie critiques, like when someone doesn't hear a movie, they'll say like, oh, the script seems AI generated or something, or like this whole movie seems like it was generated by AI. And it's weird how it's kind of becoming like an insult in some capacities, or in some like contexts rather. But in other ways we're like saying, like a lazy,
lazy review.
Right. Yeah. I guess. Yeah. It could be that.
Because movies, like, there have been shit movies since forever. We didn't need AI for us to write bad dialogue. Let me tell you, I can write really shit dialogue.
But it's easier than ever, I guess. And I guess the same could be said for like developing code. Like, it's easier than ever to develop a shit app with the help of AI, because man, some of the stuff that it does some of the things that it does are concerning, like, or maybe not concerning, but they're just like rookie things to do.
See if I can make something, because I have no programming ability. I'm familiar with the premise. I've done lots of QA, but I can't actually code myself. But I have wanted to sit down with ChatGPT-4 to see like, can it make me successfully like create a calculator or something? But then my ADHD kicks in, and I'm just like, what about a dinosaur,
I feel like it could,
on a motorcycle that looks, that's combined with the Terminator?
The one thing I kind of like about it right now is there is that positive feedback loop for like learning things, where like you kind of ask it something and then you get the answer, and then that might get you to a place where now you have another question, and then so you ask it, you know, okay, now that I have this, how do I do that? And it might generate a little bit more code for you, and it kind of guides you through the process of, you know, in my case, coding is what I use it for a lot of the time. But like, I mean, I'm sure in my case, it kind of helps to know, I guess, what to ask it and stuff in like what I need for coding. But like, if you just ask it, like, can you help me generate an app to make a calculator? It seems to really like Python. It always likes to throwback Python script at me, but you could ask it like to do it in a certain language, and yeah, it'll just like, it seems to have like a kind of a cap at how many characters it can generate. So like, if you ask it to do something super complex, it'll probably max out and start like commenting out like, and here you'll put the logic for this. It's definitely getting to a pretty cool place.
Explain this to me yesterday. The longer you talk to ChatGPT, the shorter your input questions can be, even your own questions, because it's like constantly, it's like 4,000 some odd bits, and it's like, and a bit can be anything from a one letter to a word. But so like, and it's constantly referencing your entire conversation. So like, the longer you talk to it, the like, the less you can ask it. And I imagine on the same side, the like less it can put out. It's very, which is a weird limitation. That I assume is just kind of, at least like that's ChatGPT's limitation, because I'm assuming their server costs and whatever, and it would become impractical to give me infinite resources on that, but you can probably set up your own thing somehow.
They don't really make it super clear about like how it works or the ideal way to use it. Like, I saw some meme going around, or I don't know, some tweet or something, where somebody was making fun of their mom because they had given their mom access to their ChatGPT account, and she was just like, for everything she wanted, she was starting a new conversation, and sometimes it would just be like a question about like, how do I give me a recipe for I don't know, squash salad or something. My mind is completely blank on food for some reason right now. But people, like, the comments, it got like totally ratioed with people saying like, yeah, that's how you're supposed to use it. Like, the further down or the further into a conversation you get with it, the more it kind of references other bits of that conversation. So like, if this person was kind of making fun of people who start up a new conversation with it for every topic, and he was like, the alternative of just like using the same thread and like starting new conversations with it constantly would be like polluting its responses with your previous conversations, and like,
which,
how it processes the data.
Which is fun to do with image process generation. Like, if you're trying to generate like wearable ideas and stuff, totally. Which I've done, like, it's super fun because you're like, oh yeah, I see the supreme, you know, influences on this now, like, new, I have this like Buzz Lightyear streetwear thing I made after like a long conversation of doing all kinds of things. And like, it's fun to see those influences in some aspect, but you're 100% right. But yeah, like, if you're trying to actually get like a clean, solid answer, you gotta start from scratch.
Yeah. And like, it can definitely build off of your conversation. It's not, but yeah, they don't make it completely clear, I guess, but probably because they're just trying to get people to try it out and don't want to make it like overly complex of a learning curve. It's just like, here's a chatbot, just talking to chatbot.
Well, they probably, for their own learnings, it's probably interesting to kind of see how those compiled, you know, conversations turn into certain things, I'd imagine, because part of what I think makes, you know, where you're going to find the interesting and new and nuanced like discoveries is in those like long threads. You're like, oh man, like at the beginning of this conversation, he asked him about the TV show The Dinosaurs, and then he started making a newspaper about the metaverse, and like, isn't it weird the way like it brought back this reference to dinosaurs later? Like, that's so interesting.
Yeah,
I've totally never done exactly that at all. Never.
You mentioned ADHD earlier. Like, obviously, I have it too. So it's like, you could definitely go down that rabbit hole of like one thing that makes you think of another thing that makes you think of another thing that makes you think of another thing, and they're all kind of loosely related. Maybe AI will start to get stuff like, maybe like how our brains work, where everything is connected in a web of like loose relationships.
Just ask it for something and it'll be like, no, this is what you really want. We'll get to this in like 2 hours, but I'll just give it to you now.
If AI could just like organize every, like all of my files for my entire life and all of my physical like things that I own, like in a perfectly understandable and like intuitive way, like it can take over. I don't care. I'll capitulate. Like, that alone would be so, so valuable. Like, I recently rewatched that movie She with Joaquin Phoenix, and the AI that's voiced by Scarlett Johansson. And the first thing that it does when he boots up the OS is what they call the AI in that movie. Like, the first thing she does is like, oh, I see, like, do you want me to clean up all your files for you? And then it just instantly, like, that's the first thing. Just everything gets perfectly organized. And I feel like that just takes so much time, you know, to organize things.
Well, I'm sure it won't be long. I mean, I feel like that's just kind of the next big step we're going to see with mobile phones, is built-in AI to, like, organize and manage things for you.
Totally. Speaking of,
I would love a mini boss that just tells me, like, this is what you're going to do today to become like a millionaire. Just do this and we've got you. And you're like, okay, thank you. Thank you, chat manager bot. You are in charge.
Right. It's like, yeah, then some days when you're not feeling it, you're like, can you turn down the like aggressive motivational bullshit by like 5% today?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're gonna write 2,000 words on this topic. No talking back. I'll edit it for you when you're done. You're like, okay, ChatGPT, thank you very much. I'll see you in a couple hours.
Somewhat related to new technology, but also kind of like aiming back towards the metaverse. The Apple Vision Pro just came out yesterday. Has anybody tried it yet?
I watched. I just watched a review from that dude, the African American dude who has like the most. I can't remember his name of this channel because I don't remember any of these names. But
MKHD.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I just watched his like 38-minute review of it. I'm like, it does. I'm pretty. I hope enough people buy it because I cannot currently afford to justify $3,500 for that piece of technology. I need to, you know, save up $2,000 to buy a new computer. But I do hope that it like gains enough traction that they keep building on that because it looks pretty sweet. Like you can like, cause, like when you have it on, like you can just have the screen, like whatever screen you want, it just floats there like perfectly. It doesn't hover. Like you just like, here's the screen, and then you can turn your head and like, it's not actually true see through. Like it's not like you, but it's like showing you a video of the room you're in. I don't know. I'm pretty excited for it. I don't know. I wish that I could justify like just, you know, wasting money on it, but.
It is definitely like innovation within the VR space, but like what I like, Apple has always been that brand that will release something and then like, you know, just inflate it or keep it at their inflated price, because it's like if you buy Apple, you're buying the name in a way, like that's what you're paying extra for. But like, let's say a competitor such as like Android can come out with the same technology, like, you know, years later and even improve on it and for cheaper. So I feel like that might be what's going to happen. It's not going to be Apple that's going to like make this whatever is currently out right now, like more affordable, more accessible, but it'll be a competitor coming into the market.
The real thing Apple is working for is just how easy it is to like take the, like, you know, if you've had an iPhone since they first came out, like your life is on that thing, and when you buy a new Apple product, your life is already on that thing, and that's what they really have going for them. That's why like that's where that 33% like sort of surcharge comes in. It's just like, oh, like my life is already on this. That's perfect. So I feel like that'll might help them get more people and to try out the VR space. Also, yeah, they don't call it VR,
the ecosystem upcharge.
Spatial computing.
Yeah, which makes you wonder what why they're making that distinction, because it's like they don't seem to be very like aimed at gaming. So it's almost like they're kind of hinting at being more like metaverse, like more dedicated to the metaverse, I guess, because they're not like selling their own game controllers. Like you can hook up a PS2 controller or something like that that uses Bluetooth to it, but like I feel like they're kind of like they seem to be headed that way. I don't know.
The thing that terrifies me about it is the eye tracking stuff it does. Because, like, it's cool, the, like, control side, where you're like, oh my god, I can, like, type with my eyes and, like, tapping my fingers together. But, like, when they're, like, just as, like, a market research part of, like, what part of the screen are their eyes looking at? Like, because there's that scene in Ready Player One where he's like, research shows we can cover the screen with up to 80% of the screen with ads before users start having seizures. Like, that's the part that I'm, like, kind of terrified about. It's just the, like...
Oh, wow, I didn't even think about that. That's a pretty good point. I mean, I guess using eyes as controls, like there's no other way to really do it, but
yeah, that's like a good point. I'm sure you could. Where your eyes are going is like they're going to be able to optimize advertising so amazingly.
Yeah, track exactly how long you looked at something.
Yeah, it's like because like I had so that's like the scare, like, you know, but whatever, there's always some give and take. And to be fair, Apple is the shocking company that made it like impossible for everyone to like track your data to like optimize ads for you. But I suspect mostly because then now they can just be the ones who do it instead of letting Facebook make all that money. But still, I don't know.
Yeah, I feel like the Vision Pro will probably be their like Pro line, and that will stay the same price, but eventually get like smaller and more compact and lighter, more lightweight, and have better like performance. And then they'll probably come out with some like Vision Air type model. But I actually did just demo the Vision Pro And I was pretty impressed by it. Like, I actually found, so I have like missing central vision in one eye. So like one eye, I have pretty much close to 20/20 vision, and the other eye is like, if I close the good eye, I can't really read with my bad eye, but I have peripheral vision. So like when I have both open, I don't really notice that's a problem. But like when I was demoing this Vision Pro and watching this like immersive 3D video they had me watch, I was like, holy shit, is this what everyone else sees? And I don't know if it was like more impressive for me because of that, or if it would be equally impressive for anybody because we're just so used to watching like 2D videos on a flat plane. But like the resolution was pretty impressive, and there was definitely like a lot of peripheral vision missing, but hopefully they'll fix that in later versions or something if they can. But definitely was pretty cool. But even cooler is I've heard that Meta, like the next version of whatever Quest thing Meta is coming out with, is supposed to like blow this Vision Pro thing out of the water. So I feel like
competition is always good. That's where like that's the real nice thing about it.
It's really starting to feel like we're on the threshold of like major huge companies with billions of dollars to throw at projects going like full force into the metaverse, you know, like seeing it as the future. So we're not just crazy weird tech nerds.
Yep.
And we kind of still are, but
we can credit it to Apple kind of like with the release of their headset. It's like something that's like fresh in the market that hasn't been done yet. It's not as bulky, it's not heavy, or it's not a screen on your face.
Yeah, and it's not like marketed towards gaming, so it kind of begs the question of like the average consumer, like, so what is it for then, you know?
And mm-hmm.
It's like spatial computing. Well, what is that? How do I use that? You know, is it like a computer where I sit down and I use it at like a workspace, or is it like my phone where I kind of like use it on the go? Can I drive with it if I can see through? You know, like there's not even a law regarding that yet, I'm sure. Like we have all these like cell phone laws that kind of carried over to smartphones pretty well, because people have always been driving on their phones even before they could like be on a Twitter space.
Well, technically you're covering your eyes, so I feel like probably frowned upon. But I do know that it has fast enough relay in the video that you can like play ping pong. That's what.
But like really dark sunglasses cover your eyes too.
Yeah,
but it's like not really you looking at the road. It's like cameras with really low latency. Yeah, but it's still a camera relaying the vision to a screen and then to your eye, which I feel like, I don't know. They say the latency is only like 10 milliseconds or something, so like less than a blink of an eye. So
yeah, for all intents and purposes, it is basically transparent, but it is in fact not transparent. So I assume,
right? Yeah, it's an interesting like moral conclusion, though. I guess the main argument would be like, if it suddenly turned off, like how long would it take you to rip the thing off your head and like not hit somebody, you know?
Or could you just chew through it? Sorry, go ahead, Beardo.
No, that's okay. You go ahead. You're the host.
No, that's all I was going to say. Like, or if you could just see through it, like, once it turns off.
You actually can't. It's the outside, when you see eyes, that is it just creating a recreation of your eyes so that the other person knows that the see-through is on. And then as you dial it up so that it becomes fully, like, immersive, that becomes a blue screen so that other people have, like, a cue to know, they see me, or are they totally oblivious that I just walked up on them? It's like, right. It's super weird. Yeah, it's like everything about it presents it to you as though it's a transparent screen that is having an overlay, but it is in fact like not a transparent screen at all. It's super weird. It's very bizarre.
I feel like I feel like that's something that they would build into the car itself, and like you would see it in the gloss. Because, like, think about it. You're driving down the highway, and you could see the speeds of all the vehicles around you. Like, you know, you could have your kid in the passenger seat, or your teenager, I guess, in the passenger seat, watching glass.
Swerve into you. That'd be cool.
Yeah, like you could have like you could like I said a while ago that or like in some spaces a while ago I was talking about like billboards and stuff and street signs, and like something like this you could in theory get rid of like a lot of that stuff and just have it digitally displayed, right? Or you could have like a banner wrap on the sides of cars just kind of when you're driving instead of having billboards. So I mean I don't know, like there's some interesting things that we could end up seeing, right?
I mean, I just want self-driving cars so that to the point where like you don't even, there's no steering wheels. So instead of just being like, you know, what are specs for driving you want? It's like, would you like the smoking lounge or the sauna build for your self-driving car? Like what, you know, or would you prefer the nap time environment? Like I just want my car to have like, I want my back to where it's going. Cause that's actually safer if you get in a head on collision. And then we can just have, you know, the whiskey room or the, you know, the library. Like that's what I want my self-driving cars to be. I don't even want to have to look out my windshield. Like we can't be that far away from that, right? That technology.
Well, and then we can just make them like all out of Nerf on the outside. And then when we get into accidents are fun, right?
I'm open to having Nerf cars. Listen, I grew up in the 90s. Help me out here. They sell all the good cars overseas though. There's a $10,000 truck they only sell in Japan. That's like, it's like the trucks of the 80s, like those nice small ones, like not El Camino low, but like that, like, you know, that the type of truck, like, because nowadays all trucks are just big, you know, redneck trucks. And I'm like, where's the nice, you know, mid-sized truck for a hipster like myself? And, you know, apparently the answer is $10,000 in Japan. And someone was telling me you can't import cars and not only made for out of sea overseas or other markets for 25 years. So I have to wait 25 years to finally get like a modern made midsize or smaller truck, and it's an absolute bullshit.
Oh, I was checking out the VW electric vehicle, the new one there a little while ago. I think it's available in North America now, but it's like their remake of like the old school like Scooby-Doo van. And like it's actually like it's pretty nice. Like I don't know if I could drive it all the time, but like it's neat for an electric vehicle. It's nice.
I'm down.
When VR integrated cars, like that is one thing. As Lenore was like talking, like I was like envisioning, like your Tesla, like, you know, all your cameras being able to like hook into your headset that you're wearing, or even the image could be displayed on your windshield. Actually, no, that would be distracting.
I just want to be able to, like, when someone cuts you off, be able to be like, AI, call them, let them know they're an asshole. Like, that's what I want. Let me just be able to directly, and then, like, you know, because like, I feel like that's part of where road rage comes from, is you just can't, like, if you could just, like, hey, guy, what's going on, man? You almost killed me. That's not cool. Like, generally, I think that, like, you're just, oh, I'm so sorry. I'm just an old lady, and I don't know what I'm doing. And then, oh, okay, I feel better now. Like, I'm sorry, grandma. Like, I can't see you. I just pictured some young punk. I'd feel so much better just knowing it was a sweet old grandma making a mistake instead of, you know, some shitty 16-year-old being a prick.
Yeah, but then there's the other end where, like, you could be like, hey, man, you almost killed me. And the other dude's like a roid head and just, like, starts having a episode on you.
Yeah, but that, you know, that already is happening on the road. But you're right. You're right. That's probably, I can see it going poorly. You're not unwrong. But I feel like 90% of the time or higher, you're just, oh, you're just a human who made a mistake and you also feel bad about it. Because, like, there's so many times, when you're in the, like, doing it, you're like, oh, like, I'm trying to hand gesture, like, prayer hand so that you know I fucked up. But if I could just let you know, like, hey, man, I fucked up. That's on me. I'm sorry. Like, I think it would just all be, it'd be better most of the time. You're right. There's definitely that some lower end of scale where it just escalates horribly. But, you know, that is life.
Yep.
I would say people who drive slow in the left lane need more help than we can give them.
Absolutely. AI, at the very least, the AI should just be making sure that doesn't happen anymore. I've noticed that you've been going the exact same speed as the person in the right lane, making it impossible for people to pass. I highly encourage you to get the fuck out of the way.
What if like just for test we just integrate AI to the left lane, like just as like a proof of concept ordeal thing?
I fully support anything we can do to get slow drivers out of the left lane.
So kind of a segue into like from VR back to Decentraland. For Derek's sake, have you guys read the manifesto?
Yeah,
that was released this week.
They aren't doing VR. They are. I guess they're going to make the client will be more VR, you know, ready for the future, right? But they aren't actually planning on making VR yet, are they?
Ah, okay. So that's what. Okay, that's kind of like what I was questioning. Is it like, was it going to be VR ready-er, or is it going to be like they're going to make some development in VR?
Well, I don't know, because I know like the DAO has funded the Godot client stuff, which is going to be like able, like ready to like launch in VR. I know that, but I don't actually know. I don't feel like the manifesto didn't necessarily make it entirely clear, because like the foundation itself is going to be remaking the client, not in any way updating or supporting the browser stuff. Though I feel like maybe Lastrum's FUD was less wrong than the foundation wanted to pretend it was, even though they'd given me hope that he had been mistaken when saying they were just going to abandon browser support, which I guess technically would be like, well, no, we're not abandoning it. We're just not going to do anything to make it better. Is basically the same thing.
Takeaway too.
But like, and like, I mean, it will suck for people like Zesty, who uses, you know, Linux, which I think there's no logical reason to assume that they're ever going to have a Linux capable product anytime soon when it comes to the client. But I do think, like, you know, Nifty Island has shown that people are more than happy to download a client to play their metaverse experience. And I think that it does offer more control. And like, if they can in fact make a more fun and gamified experience using a client, like, I think, you know, at this point in time, I'm willing to accept that might just be the necessary, you know, route that is taken. Because, you know, we all would like Decentraland to be more fun and enjoyable and be able to show our friends it without them going, wait, why do you spend so much time talking about this and in there? What aren't we seeing, Jared? Because it looks.
What are we?
It looks bad.
It took me 5 minutes to load in. What's going on here, Jared? Okay, so with what you mentioned, yeah, it looks like it's more of they're going to make it more compatible. Right here I have it, and I have the manifesto pulled up. Decentraland's client needs to be future-proof, capable of being adapted for alternative platforms such as mobile and VR, while serving as an engine for high-quality creator tools. So it's more, yeah, you're right, it's more like we're going to make it more compatible.
I bet, because when they did the backpack updates, that was just after Madamus had a grant to do, like, he basically, I believe he finished it, it just never, like, actually got to be implemented, because, like, right as his grant came to an end, and the tech was, like, they, like, kind of, like, just did his, like, copy-pasted his product to an extent. So I wonder if, like, they'll end up doing that to the Godot client team, or they'll be like, hey, like, great work, we're gonna borrow a lot of this to, like, you know, build off of. I wouldn't be at all surprised if that's what goes down, which is, I think, fine in general. That is, you know, that's kind of the whole part of the goal and hope, I think, for when the DAO funds work, is that the foundation borrows it and builds on it and makes it, as you know, better. Yep. But
yep, exactly. Yeah, I mean, that's why I'm kind of like, I'm more of a fan of voting for proposals that will open source their work opposed to the ones that won't.
Well, speaking of which, draft, I believe it's in drafts. Yeah, the draft is up, guys. You know, the vote to require all code written for grants to be open source for future use. You know, go support that. I think that's a good idea. You know, should, if the DAO is funding something, I think the actual writing of code, I think it makes sense to like make that available for other people to, you know, build on the shoulders of your, of the giants that have come before them and, you know, keep going. I think that's, you know, I'm sure there are downsides and flaws. And as HP pointed out, Fez and I, who, it was my idea, I know the word open source. I assume that's all you have to say. He pointed out there are, in fact, different types of open source. MIT open source, there's their version, there's, you know, CCO, blah, blah, blah. I don't know all the different types of open source, and I believe Fez is going to chat with HP to refine the correct terminology to make sure it's, you know, properly articulated for the final version. So, you know, and also if you have opinions about open sourcing it or not, or what type of open source you think is good, like, go comment in the draft, because that's how governance gets better. Like, there's nothing more frustrating now than having the final stage proposal for my poorly written freeze all button platform grants, and now people have suggestions about ways to improve it. It's like, well, guys, where were you on the draft with 10 million VP of support? Like, would have been cool if the grant support squad had thoughts then. So please, if you have thoughts about open sourcing code for DAO-funded projects, like, you know, please tell us why it's a bad idea or how to execute it correctly so that it's not, you know, a mess. And don't come to my DMs like HP did, which is lovely. But, you know, like, say it in the forum so that everyone can, like, learn from your knowledge and understanding of the situation, because, you know, I'm not the only idiot in the metaverse trying my best and doing a bad job. So, you know, please.
We're trying our hardest. We're trying our hardest, Jared.
Because I think when you hear the word open source, you just assume, just like, oh yeah, like, obviously open source just is that's a thing, and it means your code is open and available to be used. But it turns out that it's not there's nuance and there's different kinds. And when you assume, you make an ass out of you and an ass out of me. So, you know, teach me how to assume better in the future. Not all words are as self-explanatory as you hope.
There's been so many times where, like, I, like, mentioned something that's, like, in the ballpark of being right, and then HP comes through, it's like, actually, this is what happened. Like, just small details of what happened that resulted in what I just mentioned, and I'm just man, I wish I knew this before I opened my big mouth.
Yeah, programmers be like that sometimes, they're like, ugh. Silly QA, that's not what's wrong. What's happening is this. And you're like, oh, okay. That totally makes sense. But you agree I'm not a total idiot for why I thought it worked that way, right? Like, you know, it's like people used to look at the sun and think that was, you know, a god pulling it across the sky. Like, you know, come on, I was closer than that. I was closer than that, right?
yeah, right. Brings the question up, and anyone is welcome to come up and answer and share, like, your thoughts on it. In the manifesto, anything that you are excited about or kind of, like, see some potential in for the next year?
I hate how much I love the idea, like, because, like, currently, if you go to the border of Decentraland, I'm sure most of us have been there, it just auto-generates parcels forever. I really love the idea of it being a cliff where you see an ocean. Like, I really think that's just a much more visually appealing thing. And it will also, like, I think it'll make edge plots, I think, have more value. Because, like, right now, an edge plot, I think, you know, I don't know the heat map of what's the most expensive parcels to buy, but I feel like oceanfront property has got to be more valuable than infinite generated plains property. And I just love the idea of standing on the precipice edge of the world, like, looking into the... Look at the edge of our flat earth, looking into the ocean.
Oh shit. You just opened up a whole new, like, thing to look for when real estate shopping on the central end. It's like, do you want to buy off a road or do you want some beach property? Holy crap.
Right? Like, obviously I would like a lovely view of the ocean. Oh, and I mean, and honestly, I hope they can evolve over time where there can be, like, actual, like, sights to see in the ocean. I would love, like, for there to be islands that you could have. Like, Exodus.town should get to, like, you know, have its own little islands. Like, you're like, oh, like, would you like to go boating out into this island, like, eventually? Like, that'd be nice. Because I know I've mentioned it here before. I don't know if everyone's aware, but, like, originally Decentraland, like, Genesis City, that auction of what is today wasn't supposed to be the be-all and end-all. There had been talks of, like, sky parcels, you know, underground parcels, like, you know, it's called, like, Genesis City in the name does not, like, that implies more stuff to come. It wasn't, like, I don't think it was ever intended to be the, like, you know, the full extent of what Decentraland had to offer. And it's nice that there are finally at least projects starting to kind of, like, use worlds and they kind of branch off to make their own little mini experiments. So hopefully there can be more, and then eventually they can be in some way incorporated into, you know, the Decentraland proper. Or, like, maybe, like, there'll be, you know, you can go to the edge of Decentraland and then there's a portal to, you know, the man who stole the world's metaverse. Yeah, like, really, like, embrace interoperability and, like, really, like, which I guess won't work if it's all client-based, but hopefully they can, keep the browser going, because I would like to live in a world where, like, when you're in Decentraland, in any metaverse, like, you know, you can go from Nifty Island directly to Decentraland, directly to the man who stole the world, directly to HyperFi, without having to, you know, like, oh, let me close this client, gotta open a new one, like, because that's, you know, that's, the metaverse to me isn't contained within an individual client and having to, you know, download 18 programs, you know. It's got to be a bigger thing that feels, you know, interoperable and connected. So hopefully there'll be some way in the future to have, like, the oceans of Decentraland, like, you know, you can sail away and, like, go to one of these other spots. Would be super dope.
Yeah, that would be dope. Or, like you kind of used an example of, like, a city in the sky or whatever, like, be able to jump into an airship and go,
yeah, like WoW style, like those, like those classics, like, you know, see the map as it loads you in, and then all of a sudden you're bam, now we're there.
And now we're there. So just to reset the room, I see Biometa jumped in as we were speaking. So did Chris. Welcome, Chris. Good to see you, my friend. We have Kenji in the house. What up, Bleece? I see Flens and you know, a bunch of friends that have just been hanging out this entire time. Hello, M. Make sure to like and retweet the room. And yeah, I mean, I guess in continuation, is it bad that I got very, very excited? Like, during the all-hands meeting that the Foundation and DAO had on Wednesday, The biggest takeaway I got from it is, yay, I can buy names with a credit card now. Rip to my funds.
For the record, Nacho, I believe, he corrected me but like when you use non-mana to do any of these things, like they are converting that to mana. So that will, all those prices will, or all those purchases will go to sustaining mana. Because my thought was like, wait a minute, like, we're abandoning mana, like what is ever going to give a person a reason to buy it, or a reason for it to not just slowly sink into the ground as like the DAO and Foundation are selling it? But all of those things will help. But I know, I think that stuff's great. I think making it easier to onboard, you know, quote unquote normies, or, you know, people from other blockchains is always better. Because like, I recently started playing like Play Pixels. Yeah, that was the Web3 game I've branched out to recently, because I don't have the internet speed for a Nifty Island. But like, I had to get a Ronin wallet. Like, I've imported many things to my MetaMask wallet. Like, I know how to get a wallet, and it's still just so frustrating and such a hurdle to like have to like get new technology and like learn, like, you know, do some learning is getting in between me and fun, and like I'm a curious person who enjoys learning for the most part. Like, the ADHD sometimes makes it harder, but like, lots of people don't want to learn shit. They just want to swipe their credit card and get going. So I think it's way better if you can definitely like logging in with Gmail, like that they finally implemented. Like, that's huge. Like, that's going to absolutely just, you know, make it way easier for people to like check it out. Like, you know.
Yep, definitely. One obstacle that I have I believe it was Shelly and Derek and I were kind of like trying to keep an eye on, is like whenever you log in with your Twitter account, let's say, I guess it like generates a wallet that connects to your Twitter account. But then you know, Shelly was trying to check and see if the show app appeared onto these wallets. And Derek, from looking in the Etherscan or Polyscan, he was noticing that the show app was going towards that wallet, but like, to check it out, to see that show app, you need to go to OpenSea, and, like, you can't log into OpenSea with your X wallet. So...
Interest. That I can see. So what you're saying is that Decentraland needs to have its own little, like, non-wearable NFT checking out section. Because it had occurred to me, because I still go to OpenSea to, like, look for random NFTs, or, like, when I'm like, oh, like, what's in my wallet? Like, that is still, like, the thing I use, even though I know we all mock about how OpenSea's dying and giving up its market share to, you know, Magic Eden and other platforms. Like, it's still the place when I'm like, oh, I need to go look at the 2D file in my wallet. I still go to OpenSea. So it would be cool if, you know, Decentraland included a way for people to appreciate those assets within its own ecosystem, for sure.
Yeah, yeah. There's, like, many directions that could go in. Like, yeah, Decentraland could do it itself and kind of spare the manpower and brain power, or it could even be, like, X. Like, you know, have you ever heard of those, like, rumors of X? Like, people are like, oh, X is going to turn it into its own exchange, crypto exchange, or X is going to be its own NFT market. Like, there's room for that.
I mean, X is it's going to become the, like, all-in-one platform, supposedly. But I also, though, they discontinued NFT support for profile pictures, so I kind of, part of me thinks they're probably... either, unless they did that so that they could fully rework it from the ground up, it kind of feels like they're trying to distance themselves from crypto. Because, like, I know that in the algorithm, like, if you're talking about, like, crypto and stuff, like, that does hurt your reach. Like, you're much less likely to make it onto a Taylor Swift fan's timeline, you know, talking about, you know, talking about crypto than you are if you're talking about, you know, anything else, which is kind of a bummer. But I don't know, I guess it's such a scam heavy place, it kind of makes sense that they're just like, I don't know how to protect people, we're just gonna nerf these words while simultaneously serving anyone who talks about them up dangerous ads that will probably drain their wallets. So I don't know, X is a bit of a hypocrisy at times.
You get fed those ads too where you're like, someone clearly paid for this but I'm not clicking on it.
Oh yeah, so many, like oh, look at this this huge gains I made on this, and I'm like, wait, that's an ad. What? Because I usually try to click not interested on anyone who shows up on my timeline just purely shilling some kind of, you know, obscure Solana coin, because I'm just like, I don't have the time to properly research the Solana shitcoin market. I just need to not feel FOMO. The very rare times any of my friends actually succeed in that space, since, you know, the reality, no one ever talks about the thousands they lost before they made $100, you know, buying crap. So I try to hide all that from myself, but the ads, that you cannot generally see less of this, so. But yeah, or the free mints, the like shitty AI generated art free mint ads, I'm just like, I guess it's possible these aren't total scams, but it's really hard for my very cynical mind to imagine that they aren't just all absolutely DAO draining bullshit or wallet draining bullshit.
Yeah, it's a little hard with X. Like, you know, like I personally, like, keep a checklist of like things that I look for whenever a new X account is engaging with me. I look at the check mark. I'm like, okay, they have a check mark, but that's one, but that still doesn't mean shit. Let me look at the profile. If it's like a profile that's like just full of like retweeted shit and like no comments or like original posts from them, that's like, you know, okay, that's slightly red flag there.
I don't mean to alarm you, Sinful. Have you checked out your profile, your Twitter timeline as of late? You retweet a lot.
Is
it GM posts? Are you retweeting that? I've noticed that there's a lot of people that are like hardcore reposting GM that, like, I know they're real people, not bots. I'm like, what is this? Like, it's like, I don't think this is effective, but if you want to retweet my GM, I mean, go for it.
Hello.
I don't see Sinful. In Sinful's defense, I think he at least retweets better content. Sinful's retweets are at least of like, community members I know doing cool things. I would say eventually, I was just more because he was like, too many retweets to not enough original content. He said, I don't know. At least I haven't noticed his retweet game doesn't at least descend to, I don't know. I thought we moved past the good morning meta. I thought that died in like mid 2022, but it's coming back, I guess.
They first off, they're curated retweets, Jared.
Yeah. No. I didn't mean to suggest you're retweeting trash. I just meant that like when I go to you, like when I'm like, oh man, I saw Sinful say a thing, or I know this, he retweeted it, and then I go to your timeline to find it, and I was just like,
yeah.
Okay. Yep. There was the, oh man, that's a lot. That's all I was saying. I was just saying that, you know, just because a person retweets a lot of stuff doesn't mean they're not real, is all I was trying to say, because obviously yeah. You're real.
Well, I agree. I agree with that too. Like definitely. That's why I say it's like that's a red flag, but not like entirely. Let's keep researching. And welcome, Arjun. I see that your mic is open.
Hello.
Good morning.
Well, good night for me already. Thank you.
But yeah, either way.
Yeah.
Leave the good morning.
The thing is that. I don't know if you saw, but recently there was like a way to pop up bots from X, and a lot of them has the Twitter blue thing. So that is not anymore a way to push them out or to show them out. I'm going to share a link about how to do that because it was very fun. Yeah, it was a very, very fun way to spot them.
Yeah. Well, yeah. That's why, like, I mentioned that, like, the check doesn't mean everything, but it does make me giggle that someone would spend the money for a check on their spam account, or you know, it brings the fuzzies out.
Yeah, Elon's got to make a dollar somehow, and I guess at this point, it's, you know, there's worse ways, but it is weird to think that someone would. Pay $7 for that, but I assume the game plan is you get followers and then like you sell it to like a real person who's like, I want to join Twitter and I don't want to start with no followers. Like I need an account that at least has, you know, a few people. I assume that's the like the business model is like that's where the money is. Is like eventually you just sell the account for like, you know, $500 or something.
Okay, this is the link. I don't know how to pin it, so I just post it in the comments section. Okay.
Okay. Cool. Sweet. I got it. Yeah, it should take a little bit for it to load. But yesterday. Speaking of like, you know, what to look out for and shit. Yesterday, I had. An ex account that messaged me like, hey Sinful, how are you? And I'm like, hey, doing well, you know, replied. And then they're like, and then I like said like, how can I help you? Because, you know, just a random person hitting me up. And then they're like, oh, I just messaged you to get to know you and chat a little bit. What do you do? And I was like,
yeah, like I'm sorry, man. I'm way too cynical for this conversation. I don't like being groomed. Yeah, someone messaged me yesterday. Delay_ETH was like, "Hello, man." I'm like, "Oh." I just naturally assume at this point anyone that actually wants to talk to me is trying to scam me. I'm like, no one actually wants to have a conversation or hire me for anything anymore. You're all scammers.
But I. There's a couple that I've gotten that I'm pretty sure that they are bots, but they're actually pretty decent. But at some point they'll ask me, so how are the markets treating you? And I'm like, that's really weird. Like I've never asked a person that, and I've never like, it just seems like a weird thing to ask someone like randomly in like the first messages of a conversation.
To be fair, I don't feel like DeFi bros are the most socially adept conversationalists, but I do agree with you that that is like a very weird question. Like, generally, you don't ask people about their financial situation as, you know, conversationally as nice to meet you. But I wouldn't be surprised if it's all just people trying to show their shit Solana coins, you know, just pump some artificial value there.
Yeah, maybe. I just stopped responding once they asked that. I was like, we'll just see how long it takes them if they say anything back. Or...
Hey, nice to meet you, Beardo. What's your financial situation?
Exactly. You sound oddly robotic today, Argent, even though I know with certainty you're human enough. And that's like, you absolutely sounded like you could have been a guy asking that question.
Well, I was trying to emulate one, but anyway, it can be my connection.
Yeah, there's like an ethereal, airy like quality to your voice right now that is usually like, but it sounds lovely. It's not but like combined with your like trying to sound robotic, nailed it. I was like,
how?
Oh my god, she's been hacked and replaced by.
How are you today, Jared? So
still poor, nothing to scam, guys. Don't worry about me. My wallets are basically empty. You're fine. Please go and talk to Sinful. He's got lots of down money to take. I'm sure of it.
I just one asset. Gonna pass it along to anyone else that might want to take it. I don't have much either.
That's the one maybe. Nice thing about being bad at investing and buying NFTs is that anyone who looks at my wallet, it's like, yeah, I'm not gonna bother sending this guy any fake job requests. He doesn't have a kid called Beast to Steal or anything.
They'll feel so bad that they'll just start sending you shit.
It was a moment last year that I was receiving a lot of those, and it was painful to my core to see all of them were scams.
Yeah. Oh, it's so brutal. I was looking for like jobs last year, and like I was like super excited about this one job, and they're like, okay, like. So just go to our website and mint this job. I can't remember what nonsense name they had for it, but it was like, you know, mint this thing so that we can like confirm you own that wallet. I'm like, that's absolutely not how that's not the most efficient way to confirm someone owns a wallet or has experienced Web3. And I was just immediately sad, and they didn't reply to my follow up questions
because they are scammers. So better. Yeah. But they didn't.
In conclusion, everyone sucks.
Oh my god. Not everyone. But it's true that we're still in a wild, wild west situation with this. It's not enough security or whatever, you know? I wonder how we can improve that. Especially in decentralized world, because it's like a difficult situation when you are one on yourself against a really, really like big, powerful scammers and so on. What do you think about it?
I still haven't tried Wallet Guard yet, because part of me deep down is like, what if Michael is just the world's greatest scammer? But like, Wallet Guard does seem like he seems pretty legit. I don't think he's a scammer, but like, there's just part of me that's just like, no, Michael wouldn't want me to connect my wallet to his website. Haven't you heard him? He gives excellent advice about this. But like, Wallet Guard, like, there do seem to be some people fighting the good fight out there. So I do think that, hopefully, as time goes on, the smart tech bros who've already like, because like also like you know, it helps like when there's people who like they minted their Bored Ape early, so they've made a bag in the metaverse space and they actually do believe in it. So there's like they're not under financial hardship in their own life, so they have the time to like build something cool by helping others. So I do feel like Wallet Guard does seem like a great spot, but you also have to then read what Wallet Guard tells you, because like it's not gonna save you from yourself, as I believe One Existence was telling the story about how it like absolutely told him don't do this and he did it anyway, because we're all human beings and sometimes we just button mash a thing out of excitement.
We don't read. So. That's the thing. Yeah.
But
yeah,
like, if you guys remember though,
but
in like early 2022, MetaMask would just be like, here's the thing you're signing, and it would give you like no indication about what you were agreeing to. Whereas nowadays, at least MetaMask is like, hey, like, just so you know, like, you're giving this OpenSea permission to do whatever it wants with that NFT. Like, you know, like, do you trust OpenSea? Because, like, technically, at any point, you've agreed to let them just send that wherever. So you're like, okay, like, I do trust OpenSea. No, I don't trust, you know, freemoney.mint.airdrop. So, but, like, I don't know, it's just so heartbreaking because, like, you know, like, the Virtue Poker was like, it's like one of the few like other things I do, and like they've gotten hacked, and like to me, who's been in Web3 for like 3 years now, and I've seen just obvious like scams and knows what to look for, like they'd made it impossible for anyone to chat in the rest of the Discord, but just kept spamming like, come get our airdrop, and like their whole thing is they offer free rolls where they are essentially giving away thousands of dollars every day, so like the idea that they were giving away $100,000 to users like wasn't absolutely insane. It was absolutely within the realm of possibility, the kind of thing you could imagine them doing, and like a few people like did fall for it, and even one guy was just like, I absolutely should be ashamed of myself, like if you understood what my job was outside of Web3, you'd be even more disappointed in me for like having fallen for this, you know, this scam. So it's like, you know, even like, you know, legit like, you know, veterans in like, you know, cybersecurity will occasionally like, you know, fall for a well-crafted, you know, scam. So it is, you know, so like what hope do newbies have? Like I'd gotten my sister to like check out Decentraland and like get, I minted her an ENS and sent it to her. And then like within like a week, she must have gotten like some email or something from someone pretending to be something. And like, she lost her, like, it was under $1,000, but it was enough money to just make me feel shitty for like inviting my sister into Web3. I was just like, oh, fuck it.
No, you gave her an experience. Like it was like, as soon as like, you know, that happened, it was like plus two experience points. Don't click on link.
But it was 300, so you know. If it was $3, okay, but 300.
Yeah, it was a, you know, valuable life lesson, but at the same time, you're just like, oh my. Cause my sister is not an idiot, but you know, like when you get people aren't just used to being, you know, sent email, like well-written, you know, phishing emails from businesses. Like, yeah, I was definitely just using MetaMask. MetaMask is a thing I have. I could have, obviously, I'll do whatever they're saying. I don't know. It's just so infuriating. it's such a risky, it's a tough space. And we just need to, you know, we're still like at least a couple years, if not 5 to 10 years away from really being like ready to onboard the, you know, quote unquote, the masses.
My mind went fast to saying 300. 300 is the perfectly what you spend in food in 2 months or 3 months. So I hope your sister was eating good anyway, you know?
No, yeah, her life is fine. She and her partner have been together ages. Like they're comfortable. Like nothing that was going to she didn't lose, you know, her, like she still ate. She is a horse. When you tell someone you have a family member with a horse, they think you're rich, but there are two types of horse people, and she's the one who works in the evenings to help it have room and board, but like her horse still ate, she was fine. Her, like, you know, it's just more of a just like, well, next time my brother suggests something, I'm probably not gonna look into it, because that hurt. You know, but it didn't hurt bad enough to like, you know, suffer. It just hurt bad enough to feel like an idiot. I know for sure I feel worse about it than she does, just because like when we have talked about it, I've been like just, you know, profusely apologizing. Just, it's not that bad. I mean, it sucks, but like, you know, Jesus, man, just like stop it. Just you're overdoing your sadness about this. I'm like, okay, well, I just feel like such a piece of shit. I should have warned you. I didn't think they'd get you with the email.
Yeah, it's curious because we know for ages that we don't have to click on links that are coming from untrustful funds or untrustful mails or whatevs. But It's how in the last years maybe the scammers get to do it like more in legit, that it looks like more legit. So it's easy to follow.
Well, because like every time, well, because that's the thing, is like there's the double-edged sword to the people like Michael from Wallet Guard going around giving the talks of like, here's what you're not supposed to do, you guys, like, don't be stupid and do this. You're also giving scammers a like, oh, okay, yeah, like, that's how I can make this a better scam, kind of like, you know, tips and advice. Like, there is a bit of that, you know, catch 22. Like, when you give people advice on how to avoid getting scammed, you're also kind of giving scammers the, just like, oh, yeah, okay, yeah, I can see why that's too obvious. Like, here's how we'll make it better.
That's the thing. Like, when it comes to, like, cybersecurity or security as a whole, you are always on, like, the defensive. Like, you know, you're on the reactionary side instead of, like, the initial movement.
But, yeah, but at the end of the day, like, the key is like, they just prey on kind of greed and FOMO, and like, just remember, like, there, no one, like, no, and like, 'cause like, that's the thing with like airdrops. Hey, like, listen, like, no one is giving you, there's no airdrop. I've never heard of an airdrop where it's like first come, first serve. Like, it's always based off of like history. There's data. Like, there's no reason to click that link in the first, you know, 2 seconds you see it. Like, take a breath, look around, ask a friend, go like, hey, have you seen that thing? Do you know it? Did Miles actually promise that airdrop? Because like, someone did that to DG. I missed the prop, they'd gotten it deleted, but someone posted, because like, DG's doing this big transfer to this new token, all this, but someone had made a proposal like with like a lie airdrop in it. And fortunately, DG doesn't have it, so that like governance notifications automatically feed into the Discord. So like, someone on the team had noticed it and like got it taken care of, and like then made an announcement like, hey guys, like, just so you're aware, like, in the near term future, there's no plans for any airdrops. Don't click any links that promise you airdrops. Like, also, because like, I don't know if anyone was here in the DG ecosystem when they did do an airdrop for wearable ownership back in the day, but like, you didn't have to click on anything. They just airdropped it. That is like the way an airdrop, like a good airdrop, just, you just get it. They don't make you, you don't have to like, you know, risk your everything to get it. So like, just chill, take a break, relax. Call your smartest friend to double check. Like, hey, Zesty, what do you think? Is this a good idea? You know? And then, you know, then, and only then, after you've confirmed with a couple people, you know, sign your wallet up to potentially lose everything. Because that's my policy. My policy generally with my wallet, my DCL/DG wallet, my basically all my stuff wallet, is like, I'm like, okay, if Miles, Spicy, and Ryan suggest it, I'll connect my wallet to it. Because that way, like, if I lose everything, I'm like, those guys, I don't have enough in my wallet that I couldn't guilt Miles, Ryan, and Spicy into at least replacing half of it with, like, a, but guys, it was your idea. But you know, once they've connected their back wallet to it, I feel, like, better.
But, you know, if they hold the responsibility... But if they don't, I don't think your strategy is gonna work.
I mean, you're correct. But generally speaking, I mean, I think that like they are, they're pretty upstanding. All things considered, in my opinion, I know there are people with disagreeing opinions, but like, they've always been very kind to me. I've got no reason to believe. And also, speaking of the virtue Pokemon, I mentioned the team did in fact, anyone who was negatively impacted by that scam, actually, the team did make whole, to my understanding. I don't know the full extent, but like, I know that they had people who said I got scammed were like, hey, like, send us an email, let's connect, we'll like take care of you. And like, no one came back saying like, oh, like, they didn't take care of me at all. Like, it did seem like the team did, like, you know, they owned up to their security failings and made sure that anyone who, you know, was foolish enough, because like, they got it under control pretty relatively quickly. Like, they did take action within 15 minutes or less. And like, you know, the whole thing, I think, didn't last more than like an hour or two of like, so like, you know, it wasn't like they just let the scammers run. So like, you know, if you do work with like, you know, solid teams who like, you know, have a budget and bankroll to like also just make right those, the, because that's what I always, I just feel emotional damage every time it happens. It's just like so draining and sad to think that like, oh man, like, you know, my friends or my fellow community members all just got like taken for a fleece. Cause like, even the people like I hate the most in the space who have been nothing but miserable to me, like, I don't actually like want to hear that they got, like, you know, I want to know karma got them, but I want it to be like in a, like, in some kind of just way, not like some other scammer scammed them and hurt them. Like, I don't want, that's not how I want, you know, karma to work. I want, I don't know. I want it to, I don't know. I just, it's so draining. That's the part that I hate. It's just so draining. Like, I hate going on Reddit and seeing, like, an Ethereum or NFT post, like, oh, like, I happened to me, guys. I got God, you know, I'm just like, oh, like, fuck. Why is this the content that always just seems to get the most eyes on it? It's like the hurt and suffering that happens to people in the space. But that's what happens when everyone's here to try to make a bag instead of make fun games and, like, actually play and enjoy the thing.
Yep.
So it's kind of calmed down a little bit, but, like, do you remember, like, probably a month ago or a month and a half ago that, like, it just felt like there was, like, a coordinated attack on, like, the crypto ecosystem. Like, there were, you would hear left and right of people getting compromised, getting their wallets compromised, their assets taken. And we were just all, like, kind of like, what the heck is happening? It like, all came in a wave, and, like, right now it seems to kind of have died down a little bit. Like, of course, the scams are still out there, but they're not as out there anymore. I'm wondering if that was, like, a result due to, like, FUDing crypto, because there was, like, you know, the ETF approval was coming.
That's an interesting, I'm always willing to believe a conspiracy that involves, like, you know, people coordinatedly trying to, like, drive prices down or drive prices up. So I'm willing to believe that there's the potential that that was, you know, to a degree, just FUD being fabricated. But also, I think that there's also probably just, you know, like, vulnerabilities get discovered, and then, like, you know, they're just being attacked all at once by everyone. So I think it's probably kind of a combination of potential influences, but I'm not the blockchain detective enough to, like, really confidently speak to, like, what it could have been. But I do recall, like, yeah, like, a month or two ago, it did feel just like scamming was just back, like, reaching, like, late 2021 levels again, where you're just like, what's going on? I thought everyone here knew better. You know what it is? It was probably that was, like, right when shitcoin markets were Solana spiked, and then all of a sudden, all of the perfectly reasonable people I thought I was following on Twitter just turned into, like, degenerate gamblers who are like, guess I'm gonna buy fucking, you know, straight to zero because I feel really good about the chances of, you know, moons. And it's like, oh, I lost all my money in an hour. And it's like, yeah, of course you did. Like, why did you, if you didn't buy Solana when it was, like, $10 to $20, like, don't buy it at $100 to buy shitcoin. What are you thinking? Come on, you're not an investor, you're a degenerate.
Yep. It you know, in all honesty, I go with the conspiracies, you know. I like to make up my own in my head. I almost feel like when Pocahontas opened her stupid mouth in the Senate, that's when, like, all these crypto attacks started happening. And let me know if you need more details on who Pocahontas is.
I don't know who's Pocahontas, Pocahontas. I mean, Pocahontas is cool. Is
what people call Elizabeth Warren, because Elizabeth Warren, I think, once referenced some kind of Native American ancestry that was, like, you know, as all white people of that age do, they're like, oh, like, I'm 1/64th Cherokee. So I will bring that up in conversation from time to time. But in general, I think it's the most Florida man thing Sinful's ever said, is that sentence right there. But that's okay.
Oh, I've said a lot of Florida shit this last week. Like, you need to hang out around me if you want to hear some Florida shit.
I do my best to, like, mute any words that might accidentally make politics appear in my timeline, because I came to Web3 to escape the horrors of the real world. And I'm really, like, I'm dreading the, like, next, like, this next 11 months or 10 months now, or 8-9 months, I guess, between now and the election, just because it's like, listen, everyone who's going to be voting for a president of the United States, like, they've already made up their mind, or they're not going to participate. Like, there's no one's going to change their mind. Like, do we, let's not, guys, let's not, we don't need to talk about it. Listen, I've got friends who voted for both sides of the party. I'm okay if you want to vote for people who I might think are monsters or idiots or morons. Like, we can still be friends, but like, let's not tweet about it. It's like, I do agree. I don't love Elizabeth Warren's position on cryptocurrency. It does seem poorly thought out and or absolutely corrupt, but there's other things she's done that I think are nice. So I'm there's also that you can say that about people on the right, Matt Gaetz, a horrible sex trafficker, but there was that one thing he said one time where I was like, yeah, like that made sense. Like, what a, broken clocks are right sometimes. So, hey, everyone.
Yeah, the entire Democratic Party being on freaking Jeffrey Epstein's list. Like, they did a thing once at one point, somehow. Somewhere.
I think the entire party is a bit of an overstatement there, my friend. But regardless, I think we can all agree that the one thing we don't want to do is ruin my Twitter timeline with your political takes. Because, I think that if you look at it, they're all very rich and out of touch. So regardless, whatever party you like, I've got bad news. The old 70-year-old millionaire does not have your 20 to 40-year-old broke ass. Like, they don't care about you in ways that are necessary. If they did, we'd all have better health insurance in some form. Whatever form you think, it'd be better, more affordable, and, attainable. So, let's just agree.
Here in America, no one's here for us. Yeah, the people are on their own. Anyway, on the shifting away from politics, Arjun, if you haven't seen the interview with Michael Kay from WalletGuard, I did pin it to the top. Okay. It's like a hour and a half long interview with him, and he explains kind of like going through WalletGuard, how to install it, the different features that WalletGuard has, and it has like an encyclopedia in case you ever wanted to use a Web3 service but weren't sure about the website or if you're using the right website to stay safe. So they have that glossary and shit like that.
Exactly. The answer to your question, what can we do to better protect ourselves and make Web3 more welcoming to people and less scammy? It is WalletGuard, other services that probably don't even exist yet that are similar to WalletGuard, like things of that nature. Because it does, Michael Kay does that, and that whole team and setup does seem to be about as legit a cybersecurity thing in Web3 as you can have. And you can even you can take your wallet and connect it to their website. I don't even need to connect. I think you can just probably copy paste your address and do it even. But it'll tell you here's what risk level your wallet's at right now based on these things you're actively connected to. And so it's definitely stuff like that is going to be what really I think helps, make it so people like me can suggest to my sister they get into the space without then immediately just getting, robbed. Because when you go to connect your wallet to something, it will check it out for you to be like, hey, just so you know, you're giving this person it's even gotten to the point where it has double confirmation windows. Hey, if you confirm this, I don't think it calls you an idiot, but it heavily implies you're making a terrible mistake. And then you go, no, that's fine. And it goes no, really, please, please really think about this. You're making a mistake. So it really makes you aware of the fact that, at the very least, you can't say, oh, I didn't know what I was doing. It's no, you knew. You knew what we told you twice.
Yeah.
So that part's nice.
I see a comment in the Central Land by Dr. Fab. I'm guessing that's Dr. Fabio. He mentions, when facing sophisticated cyber attackers, our best defense is it largely depends on the platform that we're in. So I wonder if there are any security integrations that can be done through the Central Land, whether if it's something that's put together through a DAO grant or the official foundation team puts it together.
That is a good question, because because you can definitely, as is, if you own a parcel, you can absolutely put a malicious wallet connect on your land. That is absolutely, I believe, I don't think there is anything that's gonna check for that. I mean, I nope. imagine, like, if someone reported it, you could get that land banned. Because I don't know if you know this, but Decentraland can, in fact, ban your land. They've only, I think, ever done it to, like, one parcel. But apparently someone built the 9/11 Twin Towers on a parcel, and I guess, like, it was, like, right next to someone who was hosting, like, a big event in, like, late 2021 or early 2022. And so the those parcels have been banned from the main nodes. Like, you can still go to, like, host your own nodes and then see those that content, but and there was no vote. They didn't ask anyone. Like, they just, which I do believe is in the terms of use or content policy that the foundation can do that. But so, like, technically, the foundation does have the ability to, you know, monitor and take care of malicious or shitty things. So I agree, they should probably be more proactive in protecting the users from stumbling across malicious wallet connections.
Yeah. Yep. Like what you mentioned, like with parcels, like I've seen those parcels before, like something that, like, you know, you like, it'll be like an empty parcel or whatever. And for some reason it'll have like a button for you to click on. It's like, it's like, you know, it instantly opens your wallet signature thing. It's like, do you want to allow access?
Yeah. Always no. Always hit no on that. Never give anyone this. It's never worth it.
Yeah. Even if there's a naked bot account on that land being like, hey, click on this. No, just be like, I think I won't.
It's all ENS's fault. There was one awesome airdrop that, you know, most of us missed out on because we got here just barely too late. And then we've all ever since just been jonesing, like, someday someone's going to give me lots and lots of free money. Surely. But, probably never going
to
happen.
One question. One question. Now that we're talking on Decentraland and so on, because I'm trying to publish my DCL build for the Music Fest into my world, and I don't know how. So if anyone knows how, please let me know.
To publish to a world?
Yeah, to my own world. I was trying to upload my scene from the SDK 7 that I did in the Visual Script, Visual Studio, into upload the scene in the browser, SDK 7. And I'm finding out that always when I'm doing it, it tells me there's an error. So I don't know if I zip it correctly, the scene, if I'm missing something, or what else. I really don't know what is failing.
I would, if I was gonna try to solve that problem, I'd ask Rustan, but maybe try, someone in the CBD Discord must be like a Lastrum, or someone must know the answer to that. I certainly, I'm not. I've never even published my own mediocre world of any kind, let alone trying to do anything with SDK 7 or anything. But I certainly know it's possible.
Yes,
like, I know
it is.
Nikki.
Yeah.
So I'm sure. So I would ask someone in the CBD, and hopefully they can help out. Because I feel like Sinful's the least knowledgeable world builder.
I am the least qualified to be here. Usually, like I mentioned, my better half, Knessa's here, and Knessa would...
No, a little bit. Where is Knessa, by the way?
Probably out on vacation, currently driving, I believe, as the space is happening. Or at least that's what she told me. And that's what I stand by. But also, I mean, there are some builders in this chat right now that could possibly help.
I
see some of you. Yeah.
Yep. There's Dr. Drip. There's Unknower right there. There's Rustan. Let's see. There's KJ down there as well. Like, yeah, there's plenty of people that could help out.
But I suspect that's the kind of problem you need to see. Like, it's not I feel like that's not a problem you can solve, like, without a visual, like, seeing what their problem is. But I don't know, maybe I'm just
wrong. Sharing about the screen, you mean. Yeah.
Because you're right, though. I suspect KJ would also be, who's also, I believe, a last slicer. I'm pretty sure.
KJ's the first slice.
I know that KJ Walker made the outfit. I always, the that horrifying pizza feet. I hate them. They're weird and they make me so uncomfortable. But then someone was like, you know, KJ made it, so you got to shut up. I'm like, yeah, I don't feel good about besmirching KJ's work because the pizza feet just make me so uncomfortable and I can't really figure out why. But someone needs to make a word for a phobia of pizza feet because they just make me so uncomfortable.
I like them. They like flap, like you know, like the pizza, like as it's taking its step, it's like curled, and as it like goes forward, it like flaps forward.
I mean, honestly, I didn't. That's amazing if that's true, that there's any kind of malleability, or if they even just give you that illusion. But they're so weird. Mission accomplished for, like, if the assignment was make a pizza ninja, like, you crushed it. But the pizza feet are just so horrifying to me. And, like, I had to more nuance my objection to the pizza ninja. Because I've definitely been besmirching it since, like, late 2021 when I first saw it. It was like, oh my god, this is horrifying. And I had to really think about why I didn't like it. And I figured out that it is, because, like, because they're not pizza shoes. They're very thin. Like, those are not shoes. Those are pizza feet. And it just horrifies me. And we're in a way that, like, is absolutely unhinged and can't really be articulated.
Well,
it's like a... Go ahead.
It's more like unhelpful. You know, it's like cheese in the floor, you know? So it's like, ugh, you know? Maybe it's because of that.
But regardless, it's
really, really fun to see pizza feet.
But I assume KJ is probably like one of the first five blast slicers, since she was there long enough to make one of the things you get for buying the NFT. So
I'm kind of curious, is it like the idea of like the feet being pizza, or like the idea of eating like pizza like feet that's like bothering you the most?
I don't know, but I don't.
Let's dig into this. How does this make you feel?
Honestly, the idea of someone eating my feet does make me very uncomfortable. Now that you've suggested that, I also don't. Unrelated.
You're gonna have the weirdest dreams after this case.
Feet in general are just gross. I don't get people who are like into feet at all. I don't want to eat, but the pizza feet, I think it's the idea that, like, you know, pizza is not a robust building material. Like, that is not, like, something you could really, you know, you can't traverse the desert in your pizza feet. It's just, yeah.
But on the metaverse, anything is...
absolutely valid, but, I don't know, but I'm also, like, I'm weird. I generally, unless I'm rocking, like, my Nicky Fuego skins, I generally try to be more, like, you know, realistic in my, like, you know, my style choices. I'm not, like, a DJ Trax who's, like, I want to be a robotic dinosaur with five wings. You know, I'm kind of, like, give me my joggers and some nice shoes and a, you know. So I'm a weirdo. I'm, like, the one dude who came to the metaverse to not be a dinosaur. I'm, like, no, I want to be skinny and fashionable. That's my metaverse fantasy.
Want to have go ahead.
No, you go ahead, Simple. I've cut you off many times.
I was just going to say, Jared wants to have that big Hagrid beard on the metaverse.
Exactly. I'm like, I can't grow facial hair, like, decent facial hair in real life. I want my giant beard. I want the, like, real life things I can't have in real life because I have mediocre genetics. And that's, you know, beautiful beard, long blue hair. These are the things I want that I can't get in the real world. I don't want pizza feet or, you know, 14 wings. That said, it's absolutely a valid use of the metaverse if you want to be a giant robot with pizza feet and, you know, wings. But I ain't the one. But you're right. You can be anything in the metaverse and your pizza feet will not dissolve in the ocean. So that's a good thing.
And how does that make you feel?
You know, I feel like I was, you know, I needed more hugs when I was younger, and then I'd be more comfortable with pizza feet. That's really, you know, obviously that's where my trauma all started. Was not enough pizza parties as a kid.
It all started when I was four. My mom bought pizza, and I reached in ever so slowly to have a slice. And as I got the pizza and pulled it from the box, it slipped from my hands. and splattered all over the floor.
And the sauce burned my feet because it was so hot. That's all coming together now. I wonder how many people we've lost since just talking about pizza. Yeah, I guess that seems fine.
Yeah, I think you've actually gained people talking about the pizza foot fetish.
Yep. We're all trying to, just finding our deepest, darkest secrets here, exposing them. We know Jared doesn't like pizza feet. Argent hates hacker.
Ethical hackers, no, I don't hate them. You know, it's only scammers, hackers.
Yeah. I'm as jealous of ethical hackers. I'm just like, man, I watched Hackers when I was, a child. I don't, shout out to the 1994 or 1995 classic Hackers starring Angelina Jolie. Just never got those skill sets.
Mr. Robot more recently.
Yep. Did you ever have that hacker fantasy, Jared? I know I went through my hacker phase.
Absolutely. When I was a teenager, I was like, I'd met some like other nerdy kids on the internet in like the AIM, I don't know if there was a very common Trojan horse called Sub7, where you could input that up there. There was two apps. There was one where you could send to someone and they would corrupt their computer, and then another you could open to like look at what other people were doing on their computer. And someone was trying to like, hey Jared, like let me send you this. It's super cool and interesting, and here the things are. And I just like immediately infected the home computer with this Trojan horse. Like immediately. Like he's like, oh yeah, don't open that one, open this one. And I'd already opened the wrong one. So he was very kind and helped me password protect. Because you could then, like, if you infected someone's computer, you could then password protect their computer. So, like, only you could be the one spying on them. So he was very kind to help me set up a very, like, long 26-letter password. Regardless, in that moment, I was like, you know, maybe I'm not cut out for this life. I ain't the one who's meant to be committing felonies. Because I'm sure that, I don't know what level of crime sending someone a Trojan horse would be, but I assume it's somewhere on the list of crimes.
Bro, you mentioned AIM, fucking golden era of the internet. you could have been normal and just like downloaded a song from LimeWire or something and gotten the same effect, minus the password protection.
Touche. That's a valid point. You're right. At least I got the full experience. But shout out to that guy. Those were the days.
Yep. Just shout out to that guy. Yeah. I mean, the good old days of giving your PC herpes in exchange for like one song. Like that was indeed the golden era of the internet.
What? Herpes?
Do you remember LimeWire, Argent?
No, right now. Refresh.
How do I describe LimeWire?
You know how, like, what's the correct term for the, it's like one of the, you know, like nowadays you can like pirate movies anywhere. It was like one of the early versions of like, you know, pirating software, like Napster. It was like Napster, but like, you know, with more porn, like Kazaa, like it was in that family of soft things. was where you went to find, you know, all the your favorite songs. And
like torrent,
but free torrent. Yeah. So you were just straight up downloading the file, like as opposed to having it properly seeded, I think. But similar the precursor to modern day torrents for sure.
Yeah, precursor to like Pirate Bay and all that. Yeah, that was LimeWire.
You can get your LimeWire hoodie. LimeWire has made a comeback in recent days. I don't know, someone must have bought the company or something to like rebrand it. But, yep. There was a free hoodie drop at one point. They did like a year or two ago in DCL. They're very like comfortable, soft looking hoodies.
Yeah, they were doing some stuff in like Twitter Spaces a little while ago, like a long while ago, like probably a year plus. But they were definitely
Shout out to Bleeze, who is no longer in the audience, but he got a follow from them. He was tweeting about them and saw them and was like, he was like, my 13-year-old self is so happy.
Lucky.
So yeah, no, LimeWire is they're doing something. I think they have a token or they're I don't know. I don't.
Yep.
There's too much in Web3 is the problem. Yeah, too many tokens. I can't keep up.
With LimeWire, it's you know, they completely rebranded. Instead of like a herpy giving software, now it's a NFT marketplace. And they released their token, which is like LMWR. And I'm kind of upset about it because like it recently had like a huge pump where like it went from like 10 cents or some shit like that to like 25 and so on and so forth. And I'm like over here like, balls, I should have bought.
That's how I hate every time there's, that's why I try to just stay hyper-focused on not learning about other things. Cause like there's no worse, like there's all different types of pain you can experience in Web3 with tokens. Like, oh, I bought it, it went down. Oh, I didn't buy it, it went up. It's like, don't shill me your coins because I'm not going to buy them. I'm too broke to gamble on the thing you're suggesting. And if I don't know about it and it pumps, that's fine. That's totally cool. It's the coins that I'm like, I briefly thought about buying that then pump. Those are the ones that like hurt me the most. I'm just like, oh, I almost bought that and it is 1,000% up. Son of a bitch. Why didn't I do it? Those are the ones that hurt absolutely the most.
Oh shit, I'm looking through LimeWire's website. It says that it's backed by industry titans such as Deadmau. Okay, I'm in.
If you only had known that sooner. That's probably why, maybe that's why it bumped.
Take my computer's virginity and turn it into whatever you want it to be.
For those of you don't know, the only reason Sinful's even here in the first place is because of his love of the Deadmau.
yep. 2021 music festival. Yeah, luckily I found out like literally a day about the Centraland, literally a day before he performed, and I was hooked instantly.
That actually, I can't remember who I was talking to in at Vroomway, not this Friday, but last Friday, but it had kind of occurred to me why there is, because like, my position is, you know, Decentraland doesn't need more DJ battles, because this person was kind of speaking in favor of MetaTrekkers. It was a DJ in there, so obviously like a DJ who's been paid to perform is going to be more inclined to be supportive of that event. But like, they were kind of like, well, what are you even here in Decentraland for if like you don't love music? And I'm like, I don't even understand that question, because like I did make my gateway to Decentraland via the true NFT. Like, I'm not a music person. My friend just happened to be their community manager. Is kind of like why I got here. But like, I don't view Decentraland as a music platform. But like, the large majority of people that did, like the biggest influxes of people here did come for music. So it does kind of make sense why there is such a, like, you know, performance based, you know, like DJ battle. Why that's such an effective way to milk the DAO for hundreds of thousands of dollars? Because like, yeah, like, lots of people here do love music.
I like music, but I also have talented friends in this space that also love music, and we can all love music
and we
together.
Don't need to pay. And you also, like, you don't need to pay a graphic designer $22,000 to like love music. Which is why, as JJ still in JJ 64, like I think he's at a grant request right now for like, it's like, I want to say $10,000. It's a pretty reasonable grant request. Like, I mean, I don't know him intimately well, but I've seen him around since forever. Like, I know he's like, you know, he's a community managing or like, you know, intimate with like some Hispanic communities. Like, I don't speak Spanish, probably why our circles don't cross that much, but like, he's got a cool one. I think he's going to do 30 performances, like, and it'll be like, he's gonna get part of it, like, he's gonna buy like get a good laptop and then use the rest of the money to like pay performers, and like he's gonna go around and like get live artists and do like real world similar to what the inn is doing in Amsterdam with their stuff, but like also I believe for way less money. So like, You know, why pay meta trekkers, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars when we can pay 10 dudes, you know, $10,000 to go around and like do the same thing? Like, if we agree that like that is a, which, and I think, you know, obviously music has been pretty good at helping expand the DCL audience. So like, it makes more sense to be paying, you know, the one dude, hook him up with a dope computer for his time, and then like have him go and find people and hook them up for theirs, and like, you know, do it that way. If we're going to, if that's, if we wanted to be doing music events as a community, which, as the guy who suggested we freeze grants, except for the platform, I'm like, you know, obviously more of the like, ah, like I love you, but no, maybe, but like I did vote for his, because even though I should, everyone should be forewarned that if you submitted your grant after the grant freezing proposition, if that passes, your grant won't happen, and I apologize. Please don't hate me. I still love you, and I apologize for the timing on how that might have worked out. Please don't hate me. I'm really sorry if that's how it works. I honestly didn't think Esteban would endorse my idea and that it would pass. So again, if that happens to happen, please, I still love you, and don't hate me. I think in the long term, it would be better for DCL if we spent some time just focusing on making the platform better. Because I think we all agree it's kind of a little bit of a rust bucket that could use a new paint, coat of paint, and, you know, lots of improvements, so that, you know, when you try to load into a music event, everything loads and your computer doesn't start, you know, with the fan doesn't start going, need more power for cooling. So like, you know, but anyway.
I agree, but there's also a deeper issue where, like, it's like all these great things could be made from the DAO and stuff like that, but it means nothing if Foundation just, like, doesn't give a shit.
Yes and no. That's, I mean, that's not strictly true, because, like, as HP has, like, shown, like, you know, he was in Exodus World on his mobile device, like, using, you know, a third-party, you know, DAO-funded, like, technology to, like, access Decentraland, like, Decentraland doesn't have to be like, you can access everything about Decentraland without using a Foundation made product. Like, it is possible. Now, I agree, ideally there'd be, you know, cohesion and like kind of a team effort between the two, but like, we are not strictly dependent on the Foundation getting their head out of their ass.
When I see all these issues with NFT metaverses and so, I still thinking why all these people does not look on the already existing metaverses that worked for over 20 years, and how they approach those situations and how they manage them. Because it's not about decentralization, mostly, of these things. So it's about the technology that you're using it and how you're using it, and having clear what your platform needs to offer, like security or better and faster cohesion for the interface to work, and for the people that is getting access from the web or the mobile or the app have a similar experience, even when it can be customized on your computer capabilities. It is true that as we are doing something that is related to technology or technology itself, the one that we have at home, it should also develop. The problem is that technology for the regular user, especially computers, is still a product that is an expensive product. So how you can, or how you can make a metaverse to work fine on cross or independent on the platform, cross platform. And because, you know, it would be really awesome also, not to me, because I don't have PlayStation 5 or something like that, but it could be really cool to experience in console Decentraland also as well, or any other metaverse that in that it relates to NFT world and not NFT world. So to me, it's still very, very curious why, for example, when I am in places or in metaverses that they say, oh yeah, we are launching this and it's super new, no one did it. And I am thinking automatically, yeah, I saw that already over 10 years ago. So why is this new? Or why, we are putting the camera, for example, capabilities, or photography capabilities, or a sound that is, how do you say it? I don't remember, but that is from the voice, from the source, and then I forget how you say it in English. Spatial audio, and all these things, you know. And to me, it's like, whoa, why you don't have that already? Look how it works. Why you didn't do the job or the study that you need in order to make this NFT metaverse platforms to work correctly for all these things that already exist and that are very popular and that has proven that is something that attracts a lot to users?
Well, I think part of it is that like building in a decentralized space is like in like or like take trying to make like a DAO, the technology to kind of make that decentralized autonomous stuff work. It's like you have to make like there. It is harder, but like for the goal, like I need Morph to be here to explain it better. But like from the technology side of things, I totally agree with you that I think a lot of people just overhype. Not that like not innovation as innovation, because like I think there's a difference between true innovation and then being the first person to do it in Decentraland. Like whenever like someone does the like when you're the first person to do something in Decentraland, I think that's cool. But that doesn't actually mean you actually innovated anything. You just kind of figured out how to bring something that already exists into this clunky, awkward, you know, decentralized workflow environment.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So it's mostly
I agree with you. For the technology. And this is not, let's put it clear, the technology is not related to decentralized thing. The decentralized thing is later related to how to make it work in a blockchain system that has an economy and all these things. That is the other part. That is the blockchain related part. That is the economy, decentralized economy, if you want to say it. So to me, it's like still I see a lot of FOMO things that already exists for way longer. And even not only in games, as I said, in metaverse platforms that are centralized, but some of them are open source and it works also as PFP. So peer-to-peer, I mean. So it's decentralized. It's just that they are not in the blockchain. So to me, all these are like... a lot of FOMO without the correct research and the correct want to do the things. It's like people rush.
But a lot of the cool things you're talking about are like they're using Unity, for example. So I know there's a lot of people their argument is kind of like, well, if you have to have Unity to make this cool thing, like you're not.
I am using Unity, I'm using blah, 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 yes. But what I am trying to say is, for example, the typical open grid is coming from the code of Second Life. Open grid is a metaverse that is a decentralized metaverse because it does not run into a server. It's a peer-to-peer servers. So... and it already existed for 15 years, something like that, and it's based on the code of Second Life, so it's working just in code. It's not at all related, but you can import your creations inside as DAE, not as GLTF or USD, because this is newer, but DAE is also a free form, an open source form, I mean, that people can use as a, if you're a creator. So to me, it's, I don't know. I still think that a lot of the people that is doing these are not looking really into, okay, these already exist. What is existing and working and how they did it? How we can do this with the blockchain for our, and how we can combine this with the blockchain? And that is the only thing that, yeah, I see that there's not enough for the people that is doing, the developers, I mean, but not only the developers, the CEOs, the people that is owning the founders and all these things, they are not doing the work of the research that they need for their platforms. None of them, you know, and when they do launch something that they seems that is like the first thing, is not. And it's creating all this FOMO and all these things that is at a certain level, on my opinion, and this is my opinion, like a way to excuse for not doing this before, you know. So I would like to see that all these metaverse developers and so on do the proper research and try to apply whatever it needs in order to achieve, for example, security measures, the moderation measures. That is something that if you're hosting an event, for example, you really want to be able to put or to have moderation tools to help you with the correct fluidity of your event.
Yeah, I think you definitely make a lot of valid points, and I agree with you that there's definitely a lot of people like claiming innovation that is just absolutely non-existent. And but to be fair, though, like there's so much out there that like to say like they need to do better research is like, you know, some you don't know what you don't know sometimes. So like, you know, it's they could have done all the research in the world and they just never like stumbled on Second Life. They're just going to kind of miss this whole corner. So like maybe there are some who genuinely think they are like, you know.
Jared, I'm coming from research. I started in metaverse because of research. There's a lot of publishings, but a lot. You don't need even to know about Second Life at all that exists to find the research, because the research is at a lot of levels. When I was doing that, there was a huge interest by a lot of universities, and mostly all of them, the greatest ones, were inside or to investigating and so and doing a lot of reports, not only from the technical aspect, but also social, economics, environmental, all what you want to know is there already. You only have to do the proper, you know, research for it. Just go into Google and say, I want to do a metaverse, how I can make it? And you're going to have a lot of things related to, or in ChatGPT, I mean, or in BART. And you're going to have popping, if you do the correct, you know, prompting, you're going to have and you want a specialize in, tell me about research done by universities. and you will have a lot of these that are published already. So to me, it's like, no, there's no other excuse. It's just that, let's see that the, it's like when you have a game, you know, and you don't know how to make games, but you have a game, you know, and you want to do a game, you know, and for whatever reason, your game isn't of good, but as you don't know how to do the game properly, your game has a lot of issues. And it's not that gaming technology is not there. It's not that the research for gaming theory is not there, you know, to that explains, for example, relationship between individuals in order to make a choice or another when they are gaming and all this shit. It's that you are not prepared, you know, and you are only thinking in just one of the parts, that is, I want to do this, and that's all. Without thinking or researching and saying, oh, okay, I want to do this, but this has these implications, that is economical. I would like to have events in there. Well, what the events people need, how we can provide to them. So it's thinking, to do the proper thinking and research is what I miss any one of these platforms are doing. And I know, for example, that you can learn on experience when there's no one literally that did this before you. But when it's already done and it's done for over 20 years, to me, it's like, oh, yeah, it's just a nice excuse.
I love how this conversation has been going. There's been a lot of good points added to all this. Just want to reset the room real quick and welcome Kaguya down there. I see 044, Cowboy Tom, DJC, the lovely Sultry Dubs is here as well. And you know, kind of seeing that we are at 3 hours and 12 minutes, and I kind of want to cut the space off at 4 p.m. my time, just to kind of so we can migrate over to True Band Room and show some love to Crover and Beat Street Saturdays. I kind of want to shift the topic to something fun. I think we're at the point in time where Knessa would not last 3 hours listening to this. So it's the perfect time to talk about it. Knessa's birthday is coming up. We need to do something. Okay, and so here's a little bit of premise. Kind of...
Pizza feet.
Pizza feet? You want to give her pizza feet? Yeah. Okay, so So we found out that the Centraland will not be having a birthday party this year for itself. So, I mean, and usually the Centraland birthday parties are in on the 20th of February. Knessa's birthday is on the 17th. So, I mean, I'm over here, like, thinking, planning, maybe we could do something for those days. What are your thoughts? And if you're down in the listener speaking, please feel free to come up.
I know, Sheila.
The 17th is a Saturday, so that is a pretty solid day. And the 20th is a Tuesday.
Yeah,
I know, she likes donuts like a lot. I think I can go with donuts for her.
Oh my god! Yeah, like. Maybe we could do something special, like, I don't, you know, as Jared mentioned, my building capabilities are, like, non-existent. I would definitely like to put something together. Maybe we can have a show. I don't know.
I like the idea.
Well, we got Rustan in the building. I know Rustan's a Knessa fan. She's done him favors, and he knows how to build things. I don't know if anyone's ever seen it, but it's true. He's pretty good at it. So hopefully we can, you know, guilt him. And though I also know he's not very susceptible to guilting, I do know he's a nice man who likes, you know, who likes to treat his friends well. So but we can get him to help out a little bit if he's not busy. That's really the trick.
Welcome, Rustan. How are you?
Yo, yo. We could do a party at the Cove.
What's going on, Rustan?
Do a party at
the Cove. Okay, I like where we're starting here.
That's what I was going to suggest. Would there be any way to deploy floating donuts to the Cove?
I'd have to look into it, but Noah, I don't see why not.
Can we get some floating the donut technology with the VRM? VLM? Can VLM? I know VLM can do lasers. Can it do floating donuts?
Yeah. Totally, but I'd have to talk to Anor about doing VLM in Worlds. Does it work in Worlds?
I believe he was looking for someone to test that, but I might have misread that or misremembered a different fact. But I feel like that was a thing he had once wanted people to help him look into. So I assume it must have the potential, just might have some bugs to work out. Is he still a speaker or no?
Let's do it. We just need a DJ.
Yes, we need a DJ. I mean, I see Sultry Dubs down there. I'll contact Sultry to see if she would like to. Because I know Knessa is a Sultry Dubs fan. So, like, anytime that she DJs, like, Knessa is there.
That would be crazy amazing.
Right. Yeah, I mean, yeah, just trying to bounce ideas and see what we can put together for, like, you know, one of our most beloved community members. And welcome back, Unknower. I saw your post.
Yeah, sorry.
Oh, are you there, Unknower?
Switch audio sources real quick. Yeah, the VLM virtual LAN manager should definitely work in Worlds that is supported. So I can help you get that set up if you need it, Rustan. And yeah, Finn, you saw that post.
Let's do it. Pro. Oh shit!
Ooh, Rustan's got a new friend to hang out with in Meta.
I'm so jealous.
Can get food poisoning together. That's not the right kind of motion sickness. It's not food poisoning. That's weird that I thought that.
Yeah, so done. February 17th, right? The Cove.
February 17th is for Knessa's birthday. But, I know that she was interested in you know, doing something for the 20th, for DCL's birthday. Like, that's how the conversation initially kicked off. Like, she was like, hey, I don't think Foundation's doing anything. Maybe we could do something. And I asked her, like, what's
surprise day? Party tricker, being like, yeah, we're totally doing a DCL birthday party, and then it's just her birthday party on the 20th. Is what you're saying?
On the 20th? Well, I mean, yeah, like, I was, like, even thinking, yeah, something, like, disguised, like, you know, or, like, dual party, but, like, since the Decentraland doesn't want to celebrate itself, we'll celebrate the Decentraland a little bit, but we'll just celebrate Knessa a little more.
So we do it on the 20th, then?
I mean, I'm open to ideas.
I think the 20th is actually better for me than the 17th, but...
Sounds all the better.
Yeah.
The 20th would be a better date for Rustan than the 17th. Sorry, I'm, like, repeating because I'm taking notes here.
That's a Tuesday, if I still remember the calendar I looked at seconds
ago. Yep, it's a Tuesday. Okay... Tuesday, better for Rustan.
I feel like DCL's, it's usually easier to get events attended on weekdays, surprisingly, I feel like, because, like, I don't know, that's just been my experience. Like, this is the only thing that happens on the weekend that gets any attendance, I feel like.
Yeah, I mean, we could also kind of check and see, because I know Tuesdays,
There's an event at Spotty Land. I'll have to take a look at the calendar.
I mean, it had like all of 10 people this week. I think those are going to be slowly winding down. You know, I'll resubmit that POI removal adventure again. Not to coming for Spotty Land North next. That's what's on this. But anyway, sorry, I get distracted.
But maybe we can schedule something for right after Spotty Land. I don't think there are any events after that event on Tuesday, so it could be like a continuation to the party.
Out party Miguel, no problem. I don't think there's any reason to. I don't think it'd be that hard.
No, I mean, would love for everyone to be able to attend. That's like the main thing. I just want the people that love Knesset to be there, to have the opportunity to be there, and not worry about like, oh, there's something else going on that I would like to support as well. Like, just, you know, make the focus direct.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose that's a healthier approach than competition, you know.
So, okay. We got the Cove on lock. We'll have to get some performers. Maybe Kaguya would like to perform as well. Well, maybe. I'll have to reach out to some of Knesset's favorite peoples.
I know getting Buffalo to perform for free is almost impossible, but if he was going to perform for free for anyone, I feel like Knesset's birthday has to be top of the list, since he have done lots of collabs, and she's definitely given him lots of her time, so maybe he can be sweet-talked into that. I know he could be sweet-talked into
performing. I'm very good friends with Buffalo, so...
I'm really good friends with Buffalo too, and let me tell you what, that doesn't come with free party service. I am literally the person who connected him with DG that led to a beautiful collaboration and lots of money in his pocket, and that only gets you so far. Though to be fair, we never actually negotiated a price. We just reached the point where he was like, well, that we'll still have a price. And I was like, oh, I'm not. I didn't even want to have a birthday party, but thank you for letting me know, bastard.
I do know that, like, if we're planning after Spotty Land, it might be a bit late for Buffalo.
Oh yeah, or very, very early, depending on how you time that. Good point.
Yeah, lots to think about here, but
could go earlier in the day. Could go pre-Spotty Land.
Okay, pre-Spotty Land. So, like, what is available? Like, what
wouldn't she potentially be working on a weekday?
You are right.
Yeah,
you are right,
Spotty Land starts. Oh yeah, and she's on the West Coast. That's the part that I keep forgetting. It's 3 hours earlier.
So it'd be perfect for her. Post-Spotty Land is
probably better. Yeah. Okay, you're right. Good point, Rustan.
Yeah, we're all here just brainstorming. I love it.
Pre-Spotty Land. It would be very awkward to host someone a surprise birthday party they cannot attend during their working hours.
Yep, for real. I'm gonna, okay, we'll have to, like, kind of, like, put it in the events page of a, like, happy birthday to Centraland, and then, like, once she gets there, be like, psych! I mean, no psych, but psych.
Yeah, we all pull out our the events 2.0, not events, the emotes 2.0, like a pop thing that pops into the air, the free one we all have.
Yes. Okay. I am a fan of, like, what is coming together. And thank you, Rustan, for offering the code for this.
What about the beach? Can we get that ocean, that sweet wave back? I missed that wave.
Well, the wave is there. I mean,
the wave is in the Cove. Okay.
The wave is there.
There was this, because there's a different beach build that I always get confused, I think.
Well, I would love to talk to KJ about bringing in her awesome water that she created. I still have been able to get to work.
I just want to play Wave Racer 64 on that little wave. I just want someone to make Wave Racer 64 into Centraland. That tiny little wave just gives me so much, like, hope for the future of, like, sports graphics-y, like something like physics-based gaming in the Central Land. Very easy to please.
Also, real quick, not to shill, but yes, to shill. I did pin a tweet at the top. It has a link to Knessa's first video under her Metaposa YouTube account. So yeah, go check it out and drop a like and subscribe.
Knessa made a YouTube account?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
And, yeah, it
needs love. It needs love. I made sure to become its, I think, fourth subscriber. I'm, you know, pretty OG now, we can say. I think I saw a comment from Rustan in there. Okay. Gotta make sure I don't rug. What happened here?
But yeah, it definitely, I mean, it's super good that, you know, someone such as Knessa is branching out to YouTube, because I definitely think, like, one of the best things we can do as a community trying to reach new users is to just, you know, break out of our Twitter bubble and, like, you know, and also as just as creators in general, like, you know, it's not good to have silo yourself onto one platform. Like, even as hard and intimidating as it is to go from your, like, nice, comfortable thousands of followers to back to square one trying to get to your first 100, like, that's, you know... Oh, that's, you know, you got to diversify and, you know, be out there to, because, you know, Elon can shut this whole thing down anytime now. And like, where are you going to be if you don't have, you know, other places to connect with people? So it's too. And also, I think, you know, Knessa is one of the few people who does a pretty good job of doing a good job of helping you feel optimistic about, you know, all the things the Central Land does well. Though, admittedly, this video that she's made is more, I think, Hyper-Fi focused, but, either way, that's a good way to get other people. You come to them where they are, and then you go, hey, Hyper-Fi guys, bit beasts, come with me back to the Central Land. Also, yep. The Rustan's work is gets very well showcased in this. I've seen his kid called Beast House Party Bill. I believe he did that. I've seen the.
Yep.
I wouldn't mind a beast. I just don't know. I'm not going to buy one because that way all of you guys will make money. I only buy NFTs that slowly go to zero generally. So like,
so you're doing us a favor?
Yeah, I'm just staying out of it for you guys. Well, I want you guys to succeed.
I would actually, I mean, try picking up a BitBeast off the second market. Like, definitely, like, for a blue chip project like that, BitBeast entry price is, like, definitely very affordable.
I mean, you know, those baby penguins are things I wish I had also purchased when they were affordable. So, yeah, for 0.02 ETH, that is a... And, I mean, you've seen my PFP. I obviously prefer my art low res. So...
Yeah, I mean, it'll give you access to a new community, new people to kind of, like, talk to. The beasts are actually very engaging. They take care of their own.
They certainly know how to blow up a, like, welcome to the community Twitter post. I've seen, you know, whenever any of the DCL people join, you're always just like, that has to be their most engaged with tweet. Like, even for, like, you know, the Tangs and the Knessas of the world, you're just, who can get pretty good engagement on a thing. You're just like, damn, that has 500 likes. That's wild. Those guys know how to get down. Maybe 500 is a slight exaggeration, but it's not nearly as much of an exaggeration as you might suspect. Those guys definitely know how to say hello.
Yeah, most definitely. I mean, Rustan got a big hello. There was Stony got a big one too. Like, they definitely know how to take care of their own. Like, I'm a fan of the community.
Technically, though. I just watched Knessa's video with her little bit beast VRM, but like Miguel made that for her, right? Like, based off of the PFP, like the PFP, these 2D little guys, these pixelated guys, they don't come with a VRM, right? Like, you have to get a talented artist such as a Miguel to bring it to life. Is that right? Am I correct?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Well, like even yeah, there is no VRM for the BitBeast. Let's say yet, because those guys are always innovating. But like yeah, Miguel seems to have taken kind of like the helm on that one and spearheaded like starting to make VRMs from the BitBeast and stuff like that. And he, what I've been seeing is that he's been helping people out, and you know, yeah, never know what could come of that.
Honestly, no, few people in Decentraland like are grinding harder than Miguel. Like that guy is always just crushing it. Like done so much stuff. Like definitely lots. You gotta respect that dude's hustle, and like the work just keeps getting better and better. And it started out pretty decent, so it's definitely like, you know.
Yeah, I've known Miguel for a long time. I've known Miguel since before Vox Boards. Like, you know, he used to hang out in my stream. He used to be super supportive and everything. Like, I love the dude. It hurt my soul whenever, like, I sat down to speak with him and he was kind of, like, trying to brainstorm of, like, what to do next. And, like, he was telling me how limited Decentraland was for the concept that he was trying to bring.
It's true. Like, I mean, he made as good a skate, like, his little skateboarding Pac-Man game, which is kind of like, well, like, as pot, like there's just like there's no graphics or physics else. Like he made as good a thing as you could make, but sadly I think he did have to go to Hyperbi to like have gravity. So
yeah, to improve. And even now, like I think Nifty Island could be something very beneficial for the concept of, you know, box boards for what he has envisioned.
Absolutely. Someday I'll have good enough internet to, like, I got to play the first time user experience for Nifty Island works well, because it's, like, compact. You don't have to rely on your internet connection. It's all, like, hosed on. But as soon as I got, like, onto my own island, my frame per second dropped to 2 to 5, and I'm like, I gotta wait till, they're gonna upgrade this backwoods area's internet to, like, proper, like, cable, I believe. But right now I've got DSL, which I don't know if anyone knows about DSL, but, very limited on the upload side of things, which does hurt your ability to enjoy most of the metaverses, like all of them except for Decentraland, really, which I think is the undersold side of DCL. I think it does deserve some love for that. Like the fact that I can use this with my 1.5 upload speed should get a little shout out, a little credit. It's also rude of me whenever I complain about getting dropped in the Fatui when I launch in, because that's probably my internet's fault, where it's like, hey, you didn't tell us who you were in time. We just did our best. But yeah, someday I'll get to play Nifty Island and enjoy Miguel's additional works.
Oh, you will. You will. I mean, the space as a whole, it's gonna move forward. It's going to get better. Perhaps it'll be better for your internet and stuff like that. As you mentioned, infrastructure is being built in the backwoods.
Yeah, so sooner or later, worst case scenario is if doesn't happen, I'm just going to have to get Starlink, because, you know, that'll be my next. If there's no good internet here by, like, you know, if it doesn't come through this year, which it's supposed to, like in the next, like by summer, mid-year, they're supposed to start building that out. If that doesn't happen, I'll just suck it up and, you know, spend the $600 on a Starlink satellite.
I'm surprised no one's like taken like 4 Starlink satellites and like taped them together and like pointed them at the sky just to see if they get like faster internet than you would if you had one.
Yeah, well, because you live in hurricane country. Like my one concern about Starlink is like, this is a very cloudy, kind of rainy, like snowy area. So like my wonder is like, I suspect a satellite dish pointing through rain clouds is still probably better internet than the DSL that we have here, but like, you know, it's not a sure thing. And it would be a real bummer to spend $600 on a satellite and like $120 a month on internet that like every time it rains, I'm like, well, still can't use Hyperfi anyway. Son of a bitch.
Well, I mean, fun fact. Okay. During rain for when it comes to like Starlink, it works down here.
Oh, okay.
But when you come to hurricane, to talk about hurricanes, nothing works. Like not even cell phone reception. Like even if you had power at your house,
your communications are blocked off. There's no cable or anything because of like how thick the rain is, how thick the clouds are. Like hurricanes like create like a pressure chamber on whatever is like under them.
God, that makes sense. Well, fortunately for even the worst blizzard that has been in like this time of year, I suspect is not nearly as smothering as, you know, a category 4 or 5 or whatever a medium sized or greater hurricane is. So I'll probably be all right based on your pro rain review.
my storm expertise. Please no category 4s or 5s. Those would level anything that's under them.
Got it. Okay, then category 2, I suppose, would be a medium sized hurricane then, I guess.
Yeah, category 2, 3. Like, for example, Hurricane Ian that came through last year, that, like, totally destroyed my city and ripped to all the Lambos and actually destroyed Fort Myers Beach, which is still struggling. That hurricane was a 3, and it didn't do much to me, like, further inland, but... Yeah, like along the coast, it just flooded everything. The storm surge is what no one knows about.
that's the silent killer. Yeah, flooding is no joke. That was a real. I moved back here to like try to get into the weed farming, but I did not anticipate that with the climate change, quote unquote. The flooding does make. Well, most things very difficult, and it can really just ruin even the loveliest of areas. You can't plant things in flooded dirt. So
nope.
Anyway, let's all move to Kansas. There's gonna be beautiful beachfront property there in no time.
Let's just all move to the edge of the central land.
Oh man. There's a new Vroomway vehicle collab between KJ and the Vroomway team. It is a sinful. I think you're going to like it. It is a kitty vroom. The skin, when you're just a skin, is like a robot cat. Looks badass. There is a marketplace link that I'm clicking now. And then the car is like an alien, like not an alien. It's like a UFO, like a cat on like kind of a UFO platformy thing. Oh, man. Oh, that is hot. That is a very sexy... look up Kitty Bot and Kitty Vroom. I think that you will naturally want one. I now need to go find myself 40 mana. Also, I was talking to Nikki yesterday or the other day about things. How did this not come up? I could have been more prepared. Nikki, are you in here to be mad at? You're not. Oh, there you are. Nikki, we were talking the other day. How did I not get proper warning? But yeah, this is a very muscular robotic cat. I think that sinful, it'll speak to your soul. And I think everyone who appreciates, you know, low poly models in the works of KJ Walker and cats, you know, either way, that's dope. Everyone should go get one. I'm going to go once again, break my promise. Like, I'm not buying anything until I save up for a new computer. Well, okay. One last thing. I got to get one.
Jared, I believe this may be a smart wearable or transforming wearable.
Like, yeah, all the Vroomway vehicles have transitioned, because before OG ones, you'd have to be on parcel to experience the transition. I believe now you can enjoy the vehicle avatar shape anywhere without having to be on the parcel.
No fucking way. The transformation from Soul Kitty to like Baby Yoda Kitty. I need this.
I agree. I honestly, I also know that KJ has a soft spot for cats, so I suspect they weren't just trying to specifically manipulate you into buying it. But like, if someone had sat down to be like, okay, we've got to get Sinful to cave in and buy this. What do we do? I feel like this would be what you would say pitch. You were like, okay, here's what we got. We've got a Terminator cat that turns into Baby Yoda cat.
Mission accomplished, KJ. Mission accomplished. KJ and Nikki, good work.
I need this baby Yoda cat, like, now.
Yeah, I need to stop spending my money and save up for a computer, but, you know, that's fine. I can do that next week.
Yeah, yeah, there's no better time to start than next week. You're right, you're right.
Yeah, everyone knows the classic expression, there's no better time to get your life together than 10 days from now. That's when I'll do it, in the future. Here we go, we're swapping 22 Matic into 40 mana. Boom. I mean, honestly, though, like, that's, you know, it's a very reasonable price. That is, you know, absolutely, you know, you'd spend more on a Fortnite skin, and, you know, and you don't own that. They can just take that away from you whenever they want. So once you buy this, it's yours. Also, based on the terms of service in Decentraland, you now own that IP. I mean, sure, that's, you know, absolutely outrageous, and I wouldn't advise you to just do with it as you please. That'd be very rude. But technically, you could make, you know, robot cat comics out of KittyBot now. Just saying. But, you know, ask for permission first. Be a gentleman.
Be a gentleman. man, I will figure out a way to get this kitty. Most definitely. Go ahead.
I've got my conversion is happening. I will be the proud owner of kitty cat number 4. Oh wait, yep, it's happening. Okay, good. I thought someone else already bought one, but you're all too slow. I get cat number 4.
Let's go. Remember when 40 mana was like $400 or $200?
I do. I have so many regretful purchases from those days, if I'm honest. It's a lot easier to look when mana's like 50 cents, like, oh yeah, that's not so bad. But then you like timeline it, you're like, oh wait, I bought that in January 2022. Like, what was I thinking? Why did I know I was making TV money, but why did I spend it like I was saving appropriately? But nowadays, come on. $17.96 for a sweet, sweet little thing you can own forever. Also, though, you are right, the baby Yoda kitty is quite adorable.
It is elite. Like, it's a must have. I'm definitely going to be purchasing once I figure out where I can pull this mana from. Oh, it's probably going to be pulled out of my trading account or something. That's how you know shit's bad, like when I'm pulling shit out of my trading account.
Yeah, that's what my surplus mana was ice I had at one point that I was like, well, now that ice is going to die, I'll just hold it onto it as Matic for a minute. But
bro, you're going to be holding the bag.
I kind of like the bag. I am pro bag. I've got all my DG. I turned all my XDG into DG because I want to make sure I want to avoid any last minute liquidity pool issues where like I get hosed. I feel good. I got my DG. I'm ready to turn it into bag. I'm gonna ride out like this casino situation, and then, you know, someday it'll all be hilarious when I have, you know, when it's $1 bag, and then that'll be great someday. Otherwise, and if not, you know, I made a lot of friends losing money, so that's good. You know, nothing builds bonds like losing money together. Okay, I'm telling you.
I mean, you kind of have a point there, like. Like, how many communities have gathered and made friendships and stuff over a rugged project?
DG didn't rug us. They're, you know, honest folks trying their best. Honestly, there are times when, like, Crown Chat is whining that I'm just like, I'll just DM Spicy, who will never relay it to anyone who could rug anyone, because while he isn't a project lead, he's not in the position to rug us. I'm like, Spicy, just rug us, okay? Just fucking do it. I'm sick of listening to them whine. They all deserve it. Just, you guys. he never acknowledges that. But every once in a while, I'm just like, if that guy calls Miles a disrespectful name one more time, I say you just rug us all. Don't get me wrong, they could have done better, but I've seen worse charts, okay? Of all the play to earns, their sad chart is the least sad.
Yeah. Well, I'm not even looking at the charts. Like, that community is still there. Sauce is still talking. Ryan is still talking. They're there. They're I feel like they're owning up to or trying to make better of, like, you know, their past attempts. Like, they're here.
Yeah, exactly. Like, you do have to iterate and pivot. Like, you know, you're like the most other projects, if they had like faced half of the obstacles and like things they had, it is like, oh, you know what, we gave up, we roll over and we're playing dead. Where at least like those guys are like, okay, we've gone to back to the drawing board and we're gonna try this. Okay, that didn't work as well as we'd hoped. We're trying this. Like, that's where success comes from. Like, you can't just, like, you know, you can't just keep trying the same thing that isn't working and then be expected to work. So, like, there's, you know, got to do something. So at least they're trying, which that's why I always, like, that's why it's always so frustrating, because, like, people always be like, oh, if you, like, listened to me months ago or years ago, we'd be better. It's like, well, motherfucker, where's your successful Web3 project? I'd love to buy your token. Like, go make it, okay, if you're a goddamn genius. Like, you know, I don't know. But anyway.
You want some Mew token?
I'd get in on that airdrop. I shilled Portal Coin, okay? my threshold of integrity has gotten lower on what I will and will not, you know, debase myself for in 2024. So, but by the way, the Portal Coin did at least, they have come back. If you did shill it, you can go to their website and can, because I don't know if anyone knows, but the way you'd connect it to them was through your Twitter account. You can now, you don't even have to connect your wallet to it, so you don't have to worry about getting rugged. You just enter in what your wallet address is on your page, and then at some point in the future, you will get your airdrop. Anyone else debased themselves and would like to make sure they at least get their, what will almost certainly be worthless tokens. But I only did it for a week before I got sick of it. Whereas, I know, like, a friend of, one of the DG Crowns, like, got his Twitter account banned. He's been, like, farming shitty airdrops so aggressively, like, banned, like, removed from Twitter, and they just wouldn't, like, he got, like, one response to an email where they're like, listen, we're, like, we don't care. We're not gonna reply to this again. We just want to let you know, like, sorry, bro, you're banned. Get out of here. And you're like, damn, chance. Because, like, he's a real person. Like, Mariana has met him in real life. He's like a, like, I don't know if he's a CPA, but he's definitely like a legit professional, like, you know, person in the real world. Like, he is just, like, crazy. You're like, damn, of all the people who have gotten banned, like, and don't get me wrong, homie does tag me in way too many shit posts I don't want anything to do with, but, like, you know, he at least is using, like, he's out there, he's on the Web3 streets trying these products. I was surprised of all the people to get banned, it was him. I'm like, really? I see some real shitty things on there. But, yeah. Don't forget, guys, Knessa's birthday on the 20th. That's a Tuesday. Be there or be square.
Yes. A fake out Decentraland birthday flash.
Not that, also, remember, Knessa's birthday. That's right, it is a surprise. Don't tell her about it. That's a dick move.
Yes. No one here tell her about it. And I don't think she'll listen this far.
No, we got real boring and into the weeds on a couple of, like, nonsense. She'll have been like, oh, okay, this Twitter space was about AI taking over the world. I've got better things to do. Let's move on.
Exactly. So none of you better be in her DMs telling her our evil plots.
But everyone should take some time to think about governance process and what they think a grant should be spending on different items, because, you know, we're gonna make that DAO spending book a thing, back to boring topics, so that everyone gets distracted and forgets about ruining birthdays.
I mean, it's definitely a good time to start just winding down and closing the space out. We do have about 10-11 minutes until Grover starts up, and I gotta get myself 40 mana.
Yeah, you've gotta go sell something at all-time lows to buy some mana at a near all-time low to get some sweet robot kitty skin.
Yes. Yeah, paper hands something so that I can diamond hand a kitty skin.
Listen, I'm telling you, I genuinely do think that all the like the DCL played game skins and, you know, wearables, those are the best bet at a quality collector item. And in the event like DCL ever goes on to become like, you know, Wizards of the Coast like property with like, you know, a Magic the Gathering staying power, you know, those will be the things people are like, oh man, like you've got the Vroomway Wondermind collab that had the interoperability. Like that was one of the first things that you could ever had interoperability in the metaverse. Like that's, you know, that is absolutely the kind of thing that if the platform ever becomes the thing we hope it can. And the worst case scenario is you're just supporting, you know, two creators who've done, you know, cool stuff in the space you enjoy. So like, so win-win. I generally just try to keep my NFT buying these days to like artists who I'm just like, yeah, if that artist uses this money to eat, that's all the utility I need. Like I bought my silly painting recently that came with an NFT and I'm like, yes, an artist can eat. That's all the utility I need. If I'm lucky enough that one day he goes on to become a world-renowned artist and someone offers me too much money for this, dope. But otherwise, I'll have a painting. The painting is yet to arrive, but I have faith Anthony will send it. He did give me his Zeal account, so I know his legal name and everything, so I can at least be like, and his phone number, so I can at least text him and be like, dude, bro, where's my painting?
One last thing I want to mention, Dr. Fabio still needs 4 more people to complete some interviews for his research paper on, I believe it's on wearables and like metaverse, like what attracts individuals to buy wearables and all that. So, I mean, if anyone is interested in being interviewed, definitely contact Dr. Fabio. If you don't know how to contact him, I can definitely make the connection.
I'm still a little shocked that didn't turn out to be a scam. I'm honest. I was like, I remember seeing that guy. I'm like, I don't know. Because it was like just after someone else and, you know, the interview scam. I'm like, no, we can't trust interviewers. Interviewers are all scammers. So it's cool to know that he just actually is interested in the space and wants to just learn and write about it.
Mm-hmm. Yep. I mean, as always, like, you know, take your safety precautions. Don't click on any links to any like interviewing platforms that are different.
He does it
like,
all in Discord. Is something one of the main reasonable places you get talked to. It's not like.
Yeah. I mean, and even like you could make it into like somewhere you feel safe. Like if you want to initiate the Zoom call or whatever, like, yeah, like, yeah, I mean, with stuff like that, my approach lately is I'm going to take control. We're going to do this in my safe space, not yours.
That's reasonable.
So Jared, any final thoughts before I close out the space?
I really would love anyone with thoughts about how much things should cost when it comes to grant spending. I really would love if you guys would give some input and thoughts in the forum comments on the should the DAO create a price guide? Because I think that's a really good idea. Because like it'll just I don't know all the expenses. I've never made a game in Decentraland, hosted servers. Most of you are all much smarter about me on that topic in the list comments. Like how much should a DJ cost if it's part of a grant? How much should a dev cost? Like if you have any thoughts about that, or you want to like just, you know, make sure that some idiot like me doesn't make it impossible for you to build effectively, because like you can't hire anyone for $20 to dev. Let me know, but please. Thank you. That's it.
Yep. Thank you, Jared. Thank you, Jared. And yeah, we do need kind of like a guideline of something. Sometimes, yeah, we like see like professional dev prices being like proposed, while it's like a dev that literally picked up the Central Land a month ago, let's say, and they're asking for like studio prices, like, you know, high-end studio prices. Like we need to come to a consensus or a guide of like knowing what the work is actually worth. And I feel like on that end, like it would be like, you know, it's best to talk to the developers in the space that know what's going on, the ones that won't charge you $20,000 to like deploy something.
yeah, Madamus, please go tell me your thoughts on that. And like also the like things like we were talking about the designers for Meta Trekkers. Like maybe one of the requirements should be itemize that. What is that designer making? Like are they making, you know, five posters? Like let's have like a poster breakdown. Like, you know, like I think it should really be as detailed as possible, because like I think there's, but it is like it's kind of, it's a very overwhelming thing when you like start getting into it. You're like, oh, I am so unqualified to do this, but I am qualified to go around and pester all the people who are qualified to give their feedback. So like every, you know, like anyone, devs, designers, artists, like the whole gamut of things you can pay for with DAO money, like let's get a rough guideline, at least like a basic blueprint that we can build upon.
Exactly. And so yeah, thank you, Jared, for for, you know, chatting it up with me up here. It would have been a lonely Twitter space if you hadn't come up and started chatting me up a little bit, and then, you know, conversations getting started and everyone else coming in, like Beardo and Rustan and Knower, Argent. Yeah, really appreciate everyone's time. Thank you to everyone that has been here listening, that's tuned in and contributed to your time. I really appreciate you. Everyone in world that has been keeping the conversation up. Yeah, I guess on final notes for myself, yeah, let's keep the conversation going for Knessa's quote unquote the Central Lands birthday party. But let me see, I see Dr. Fabio typed something that he's collecting data for psychology and marketing journal, for a psychology and marketing journal. And he is promoting it to the first ever event in Metaverse for, okay, so he's going to host an event on the Metaverse for Henley's business school students. And yeah, I mean, let's check it out. Hit up Dr. Fabio, or if not, like, you know, if you want to get in contact, let me know. Beyond the NFT this Monday, we have Kobe Carrot coming through. He, dude's like a interesting individual. He is connected to a tattoo related project. So I definitely want my friend SRJH to be there, because I feel like it's an opportunity for them to connect. Let's see, what else can we show? Oh, Mo Beats tomorrow at, ooh, where's my ex? I know that Mo Beats will be featuring the first ever female producer on the show tomorrow, so that's going to be exciting to watch. And let's see what time it starts. It starts at 3 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific tomorrow, Sunday. So yeah, make sure to tune into that. Much love, everyone. And yeah, let's continue building in the Metaverse. Keep the conversations going, and act natural, everyone. Have a good evening, and we'll see you back next week. Bye.
All right. Mew, 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 mew. Hello, everyone. Thank you, everyone, for being here. Thank you, Honig, looking pretty. There's Mosquita. We have the lovely Brittany over here on her pillow. Mr. Khan, nice moves. Really appreciate everyone's time coming in. Yeah, let's head over to the True Band Room. I know that Krover will be live in 1 minute. So here, let's get those True Band Room coordinates. Oh, right here. I believe it's 170... Yep, 170 and then 78. So 100 comma 78. Oh, excuse me, I just sneezed. Ooh, sent shivers down my spine. Okay, okay. Oh my god, I just noticed I had rap music playing this entire time in the background. I hope I don't get the entire thing copyrighted. So yeah, let's head over to True, everyone. Love you all, and thank you for coming. It means a lot. By the way, Brittany, I can see your undies. All right, where is True? True, 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 true.